The NHRA is in Brainerd, Minnesota. It's the final tune-up for drag racing's crown jewel, the U.S. Nationals. Then on the heels of the big go, the countdown to the championship begins. As we near the end of the regular season, the time to test pieces and parts is over. Now it's about fine-tuning. It's about finding a winning combination. And that is a test easily passed numerous times by a living legend in funny car who has enjoyed nearly three decades of dominance. How does John Force do it? Like a fine wine, the 65-year-old seemingly gets better with age. In each of the last 29 seasons, he's finished no worse than ninth in the points. Last year, he racked up an unprecedented 16th Funny Car Championship, and this year, he's not showing any signs of slowing down anytime soon. During the Western swing, Force and his tuner Jimmy Brock were the class of the Funny Car field. They went to three straight final rounds as John left Seattle with the 141st Wally of his career. This weekend, Force and his team roll into Brainerd as heavy favorites. He's won this race 11 times, more than any other event in his career. And with the countdown just around the corner, there's no better time to be firing on all eight cylinders. Race number 17 of 24 on the NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series. Welcome to the Lucas Oil Nationals here in what is normally a beautiful Brainerd, Minnesota. But cloudy skies have not kept the fans from coming out, and it will not keep John Kernan, Jamie Howe, Gary Gerald from doing their job. Same story for yours truly, Dave Reif, standing alongside of the 22-time national event winner, Mike Dunn. When it comes to hitting on all eight, the man in funny car is doing it once again. The fifth time John Force is number one, the 151st time of his career. All of this coming off of a Seattle win, Mike. I look at this team. It walks, it talks, it acts like a team ready to make a run at an unprecedented 17th world title.
Well, that's right, Dave. And Brainerd has always been kind of a race that's a little off on the horizon. You don't consider it an important race, but it is, because you consider the fact that now the teams have basically got all the parts and pieces that they're going to run for the championship and also to get the win at Indy. Now it's time not to test parts, but to test your combination and get it set up. Important thing is, you know, we have the zoo here. It seems like it's a lot of fun, a lot of good times. But when it's all said and done, it's serious business. And if you can come away with a trophy here in Brainerd like John Force has done 11 times, you can carry that momentum into the U.S. Nationals and possibly a championship. That is the ultimate goal for every race team out here.
John Force is battle-tested, battle-proven. Meanwhile, on the other end of the point spectrum, there is a three-man battle for the final two positions in the countdown to the championship. Del Worsham, Tim Wilkerson, and this man, Fast Jack Beckman, the 2012 champion, on the outside looking in. He's part of today's marquee matchup as the lower qualified Fast Jack will take on the higher qualified Cruiser in Funny Car round one today. But of course, it all kicks off with Top Fuel Dragster, and the ladder presented by Lucas Oil shows you Antron Brown for the 37th time combined Top Fuel and Pro Stock motorcycle. He's the number one qualifier and an upset alert matchup with J.R. Todd.
Other side of the ladder, some of the biggest names in our sport, Coletta and Karamasinis. The Greek took out Doug Coletta in the first round in 2011 at Bristol. He's going to hope he can do the same thing here today.
And a first time ever that a Dixon will race a Force in Top Fuel. What a great way to start a day of racing here in Brainerd. And for more on that intense battle raging for the final position in, or the final positions rather, in Funny Car, let's catch up with Gary Gerald.
Clearly, time running out now as we determine the final spots available in the upcoming countdown to the championship. And for the three men who are involved in the battle for the two remaining positions in the Funny Car ranks, the current advantage belongs to Del Worsham. Del is in the number nine spot, but consider, just over 2 months ago, he was fourth in the championship point standings. He and his team know that they must turn around this rather alarming slump if they have any hope of being recognized as a legitimate playoff contender.
Thanks, Gary. Dell shut out on the Western swing. My, how things have changed today in Brainerd, Minnesota.
Throw out those runs you made in qualifying. All the notes, they don't mean a thing. Look how dry it is. 73 grains. We were over 120 at one point. And density altitude, we were over 4,000 feet of altitude. And look at it now, only 2050 above sea level. It is very good out there right now.
Mark Oswald told me 72 degrees track temperature. He says the racetrack is as tight as you could want it. They are gonna fly.
Oh, pedal by Larry Dixon, but Brittany was having problems earlier. Larry Dixon goes 398.8. Not exactly flying fast, but good enough to get the win.
But Dave, this is what happened when you have a 70-degree racetrack. It is very tight, and it's hard to get that wheel speed going early. Goes up there and rattles. Both cars had the same problem. You saw Larry backpedal, Brittany backpedal too, but then all the cylinders went flat for whatever reason. And at that point, she knew her day was done. Larry Dixon was able to get the car to cover. Didn't run a great time, but it was good enough to advance to the second round.
Second on the all-time win list. Larry Dixon is moving on. Brittany Force is bowing out in round one today in Brainerd, Minnesota. Well, we'll take us now to Spencer Massey and Khaled Belushi. Spencer, the defending event champion. Khaled already with a couple wins this year in Pomona and Sonoma. For more on that funny car battle, here's Jamie Howe.
Tim Wilkerson is the driver who's holding on to that number 10 spot in the funny car point standings, and it's due to an up and down season. He has been to one final round, two semifinal appearances, but he's lost the first round six times. He describes this weekend's qualifying as not at all what he was looking for. He was so upset, in fact, he went over and talked to Jimmy Prock and John Medlin overnight. He says he thinks he has this hot rod figured out. He's ready for his first round matchup against Tommy Johnson Jr. For more on funny car, here's John Kernan.
Jack Beckman says his Harley-Davidson marquee matchup in the first round today against Cruz Pedregon is a must-win. With only eight rounds of racing remaining in the regular season before the field for the countdown to the championship is set, Jack finds himself in 11th place. He is two rounds out of that number 10 spot. He also has a new crew chief this weekend calling the shots as Todd Okahara has replaced Rob Flynn. Jack has a tall mountain to climb, but he's defeated long odds before.
He certainly has as a cancer survivor, former United States Air Force man, mission for service there. Turn our attention now to Spencer Massey, who only has one round win the last five events on tour, but does have a car that has come to life. Khaled Belushi, 2-8 racing Spencer Massey, the first time racing him in 2014 is right now.
Talked to Khaled Belushi, his crew chief Jason McCulloch, just a few minutes ago. He says this change in the weather makes their notes from Sonoma and Seattle more relevant. He is really tuned it up. Told me he would be disappointed if he doesn't run a mid 70 number right here.
See Shafty, Dave Carcanis getting his driver fired up.
Well, with the conditions the way they are, that tight racetrack, there's a number of things they can do. They say they tune it up. That means they can increase the engine timing, let that engine rev up a little bit more. One thing that the teams like to do is adjust that wheelie bar down a little bit to help that car get up on the tire.
Boy, Spencer was ready. Shot out like a cannon.
Puts his head gasket out.
Despite the flame, does get the round win with the quickest run we've seen this weekend, 378-1.
The quickest run this weekend. It probably won't be the quickest run
when we're done with this round.
Down with this round, exactly. That's what I was trying to say. But you consider the fact that I think we're pushing the gaskets out pretty early before the finish line, just before half track it started pushing out. But remember, if it's pushing out of the back, that seven cylinder, it's robbing power out of the back cylinder slightly, but it still has enough to carry through, obviously, to run a 378. But had that thing been able to seal all the way down, probably would have ran even quicker.
What speed, that thing looked like a jet dragster. What a great look. Lucas Oil photo finish cam may be the most telling. You can see how far the battery extender carbon. Look at the flame coming out of the back.
Wow.
That will take us now to the transplant Australian, Richie Crampton, now an American citizen, taking on Steve Torrence. Steve has had one of the best cars this year. He's gobbled up a lot of little points. He's been to six semifinals, but for some reason has yet to punch his ticket like Richie Crampton did in Englishtown.
And with this being Richie Crampton's rookie season, he has had many big moments that he's gone back to look at. But he says that this today is his biggest race day of his career so far, because he does have the chance to secure a spot in the countdown. If he can outperform Bob Vandergriff, that spot's his.
A whole shot win for Steve Torrence, who got off the starting line first. That's going to hurt Richie Crampton. 376-6, quickest run of the weekend, but done in round one.
Man, you hate when that happens as a driver. You run the best run, as you said, of the weekend, and you get beat on a whole shot. When you saw the onboard from Richie, as soon as the amber lights came on, Steve Torrence was away and gone by almost 2.5 hundredths of a second. Here it is, 2.5 hundredths. That's what it looks like off the starting line. Steve started pulling away, then Richie started to reel him in, but just ran out of real estate on the other end. Take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish, Cam. How close was it? By about a quarter car length, Steve Torrence advances.
And what you just witnessed, Richie Crampton, 376.6, 328.54 miles an hour, both ends of the track record in a losing effort. The next pair will be Antron Brown and J.R. Tighe. That is our Patron XO Cafe upset alert. We think perhaps the lower qualified J.R. Tighe might shock the Matco Tools driver when we come back to Brainerd, Minnesota. Plus, we will have Leah Pruitt. She just saw Steve Torrence win out of the bottom side of the ladder. She's in the number 11 position, and will take on Tony Schumacher when we come back to the Lucas Oil Nationals.
The Lucas Oil NHRA Nationals is brought to you by Mellow Yellow. Go on yellow. Lucas Oil, the world leader of high-performance lubricants and problem-solving additives for everyday cars and trucks. And the new Chips Ahoy Blizzard Treat, only this month at your DQ. This is fan food, not fast food.
Top Fuel continues here at the Lucas Oil Nationals with the Patron XO Cafe upset. Antron Brown in his 300th race day start, third in Mike Dunn's power rankings, clinched into the countdown, but look out for J.R. Tighe.
I think J.R. Tighe has a shot at, and I think the conditions being cooler even makes those chances better. It's not going to be easy, though.
Nope, not going to happen. 380 with a four. Maybe Antron was there to be pulled down, but Don says my car goes A to B. Donnie, sorry, you guys have to bow out early today.
Well, Connie and the team brought out this new car for J.R. Tighe. They've really struggled with it this week. It doesn't mean it isn't going to work. It just means it's a little bit different from what they've been running. You saw they got bit by that tire shake. Car just isn't getting enough wheel speed out there, rattled the tires. J.R. got out of it when he felt it, but when your competition's not having any problems, all you can do is watch.
Thought perhaps it was a chance. J.R. Tighe's fifth start from 16th. One time he took out the number one qualifier. Thought it could have happened there again, but it didn't. Current Top Fuel standings will find that the top six racers are clinched into the countdown to the championship. Doug Coletta down through Spencer Massey. The battle, though, Mike, is going to be for that number one spot.
Yeah, and you take a look at 7, 8, 9, and 10 have already exited today.
Well, with the number one qualifier, Jamie Howe caught up with Doug just a moment ago.
Well, Doug Coletta is the driver with the bullseye on his back, leading the Top Fuel point standings. So, Doug, as we go into the first round of eliminations, what does this team have to do to stay ahead of the rest of the competition?
Well, it should be good, great conditions out here today for running. So, just A to B, solid all day is what we're planning.
Sounds easy enough to me. And I talked to his crew chief, Jim Oberhofer, as well. He said these are the trickiest conditions we have seen this season. Why? Because the track is so good, but the air is so bad.
Jimmo up now with the number one ranked, power ranked Top Fuel racer, Doug Coletta, up against the Golden Greek, Chris Karamassinis. Greek with a little history against Coletta.
Well, as we mentioned at the top of the show, he was able to beat him in Bristol 2011, but it's going to be tough because Doug has had a consistent race car all season long in all kinds of conditions. For the Greek to get the win, he's actually been going down the racetrack, you know, pretty much, you know, consistently. I'm talking about the Greek. But for him to get the win, basically Doug Coletta is going to have a big-time problem.
And why is that number one seed so important in Top Fuel? Well, if the numbers continue to play out the way they have during these seven countdown races we've had, 7 years' worth, the number one seed has won the Top Fuel Championship five times in those seven tries. So that's why Antron Brown is doing everything he can to try to chase down Doug Coletta. And he did yesterday. Got a couple small bonus points by knocking him off the number one. All Big Red, 377.5, and for a man who turns 50 next Wednesday, Doug Coletta gave himself an early round one present here today in Brainerd, Minnesota.
Some parts and pieces coming off of that car of Doug's. Take a look at there, all the side panels on that body. Look at it, just peeled it right off. Yeah, that would have been good yesterday because it's a little bit warmer. Got some air conditioning in there.
Coming up, we will have the final three pair that include the reigning Top Fuel champion, Sean Langdon, a matchup with Bob Vandergriff and Morgan Lucas, back for just the third time this season. Then the Sarge will take on Leah Pritchett. And then it's going to be Funny Car, where that battle for the 10th spot rages on. And Tim Wilkerson is certainly feeling it, and he should. He races Tommy Johnson Jr. when Funny Car races after Top Fuel. The NHRA Maliello Drag Racing Series at the Lucas Oil Nationals today, where Courtney Force gets a few autographs signed before her round one matchup against Alexis DeJoria. It was the disease ALS that cut short the life of one of baseball's most beloved players, Lou Gehrig, and awareness of the disease is once again taking center stage with the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge. Courtney was called out, immediately accepted on Friday.
I'm Courtney Force, NHRA Traxxas Funny Car Driver, and Sonoma Raceway, I accept your challenge for the ALS Research Ice Bucket Challenge, and my team is really excited about it. So, all right, let's do it. Stay brief, Mike Dunn.
What did she say?
I don't know, Dave.
I challenge you, Dave Reese, Mike Dunn.
Oh,
woo!
No.
Felt good after a day of racing, though, but I challenge you guys for the ice bucket challenge.
Oh, Courtney, you did it to us, but we accepted our due diligence, and after qualifying yesterday, we made our move back to the zoo. I'm Dave Reif.
And I'm Mike Dunn.
We're hanging out with a few of our friends back here in the zoo, and you know what, Courtney Force? We accept your ALS Ice Bucket Challenge.
We ain't no wimps. How hard can this be?
I'm sure it's very, very simple, and it's not going to be a big deal. Now, Courtney, I hope this comes back to bite you, because Mike and I challenge the Pro Stock, Funny Car, and Top Fuel winners here from the Lucas Oil Nationals. Good luck.
How about them Bears, Dave?
Mike, that was cold, right?
Oh, boy, I'll tell you that. It was definitely cold, but it was worth not having to pay $100 for me.
There you go. You're a little
we'll
tight,
aren't
you?
Yeah, we'll
tight.
I am tight.
Sean Langdon, Terry McMillan. And Sean in the Allen Abbey silver car, and you know the Amelie motor oil machine has an onboard camera. It's always fun to ride along with Terry. We'll set up this matchup in just a moment. Let's check in now with John Kernan.
And in the staging lanes with Jack Beckman heading back to his car for his first round matchup against Cruz Pedregon. And Jack, I know there's a lot of pressure every race weekend, but considering 8 rounds of racing left, you're 2 rounds out, what's the pressure like?
It's almost like somebody tells you on ring toss, you got to hit 4 of them in 100, and you haven't hit any of them, and now you're down to 5 shots, and we're just running out of rounds. We have to be perfect now. We haven't been executing well. This weekend with Todd Okahara on board, we went a slightly different direction, which we would have loved to have tested. We'll do that next weekend. It's not going to help us today. We picked away at it. We think we got a pretty good system going, then the weather completely changes, but it's going to change for Cruz in the other lane. I feel optimistic. I do feel nervous. For Valvoline, for Sin Power, we've got to get in the countdown. We really think we can win a championship if we get our you-know-what together.
There you go. Sean Langdon, 7 wins and 11 finals last year, Mike. Just 1 win in 5 finals this year.
I'm still trying to decipher that ring toss analogy by Jack Beckman. He's great.
Well, let me know if you figure something out.
Yeah, boy.
Can Kerry keep Sean Langdon honest here? Maybe pick him off? Allen Abbey Silver drives away, and a big-time concussion again. Felt right here in the TV compound. Terry McMillan's motor just let go big time. Sean goes 377.6 to get the win. It's amazing that onboard camera survived that explosion.
Well, Terry had the advantage off the starting line. That doesn't happen very often against Sean. Sean went up there and just kind of played it safe. But look how big that explosion was by Terry McMillan. It's, you know, in hindsight, you go back, and I've done this before, you think, you know, at that just before that point when Sean's starting to pull away, probably should have lifted, because as a driver, you want to gauge where the other driver is and if you can still catch him at a certain point. But when it's going that fast and happening that quick, sometimes your instinct just says, I got to keep going. Something might happen. And unfortunately, it happened to Terry McMillan.
Wow, look at all that flame leaping around the roll bar, the windscreen getting in Terry McMillan's face. Bet that was a warm ride. Boy, did you see how that supercharger about a 45-degree angle, too? Boom.
Good thing he wasn't in a funny car. Still got fire in there, though.
Boy, it looks impressive. It sounds impressive. Maybe a better word might be scary.
I felt it, Dave. Wow.
Boom.
Well, we heard Jack Beckman talk about his matchup with Cruz Pedregon. Tim Wilkerson, you say you're a huge Cruz Pedregon fan today. Put this in perspective for us. What's on the line for you?
Well, of course, any round I can gain on Jack is a plus based on next weekend, right? So, you know, Cruz and I got a lot in common. We're both fighting two and three, you know, crew chiefs say every time we race, in reality, when we race these multi-car teams. So, yeah, I'm a huge Cruz Pedregon today. Cruz, don't let me down. Don't let me down today. But, no, I can't count on anybody else. Got to do the best job we can do for our team and Levi Ranch out. And that's what we're here for. But, yeah, big Cruz Pedregon fan today. Thanks.
We'll see Tim and Tommy Johnson Jr. in the fourth pair of funny car.
Bring it, Timmy. Well, again, in ultra mode, just look at the back end of this car, belching flames, the pieces and parts that are coming out. The parachutes doing their job. That's good.
Yeah, when you have a big fire like that, you always want to get the chutes out and get that car stopped as quickly as you can, especially when that fire reaches inside that cockpit, because you don't know how long it's going to burn.
Well, that will bring us now to Bob Vandergriff and Morgan Lucas. That's the next pair. And then coming up will be Leah Pritchett, Tony Schumacher. Leah, of course, we haven't seen racing since Norwalk. Well, after the first session of qualifying, we wired up a very busy Leah Pritchett.
Hey, guys. Empty. Empty.
Come to the zoo.
We will. We will tonight. Going up.
Yes.
I enjoy the little jobs that I do. And then obviously in a couple minutes we'll slow down. I'll go up, look at my run from rear view camera, see, you know, if I could have caught it a little quicker, how fast I catch it, how straight was I, all those little things. There's something on my throttle pedal I actually need to adjust, so it's kind of like my own little workout. You get in the car and your throttle's not exactly perfect and things are in the wrong spot. Sometimes, you know, like I said, we don't have to, our job isn't that, we don't have a lot to do. We have a lot to do in a very short amount of time. Big deal. I like to stay out of the way a little bit. Obviously, so does everybody. Their jobs are super important, and I try and help as much as I can. But you just pay attention, see when the time is right, that there's an open spot for where I need to work. Because, I mean, they have that important job. They have the job of getting the car down the track right, and I just have to sit in it for a couple seconds, so.
Well, that crew for Terry McMillan's going to have a very busy afternoon tearing this machine down, trying to dissect what turned into a gigantic explosion out of the Amalie Oil Top Fuel Dragster. So Terry wincing just a bit after a massive concussion and a big time explosion. And for him, next up on the NHRA Meliello drag racing schedule, just the biggest race on the planet, the Chevrolet Performance U.S. Nationals. We're qualifying Sunday, the 31st, comes at 11 and 5. Monday, the finals begin at noon Eastern on ESPN2. And, of course, we've got ESPN3 coverage live with Saturday qualifying and, again, with all-day live coverage of the big go, the granddaddy of them all, Stack Guy.
You see Robert Height's photo right there on the promo. Just think about this. John Force Racing has won Indy 8 of the last 10 seasons, but the guy who has not won would be John Force of those 8 wins.
Interesting. Well, we caught up with some drivers that explained why Indy is so, so special.
U.S. Nationals is a big deal. It's the oldest, biggest race. It's a race that pays the most, number one. It's the most prestigious event on the circuit. You know, it's a race that if you look at the history, look at the people that have won it, especially multiple times, Don Garlitz, Perdomo, all those guys. I've won it 3 times, and the feeling that you get when you cross a finish line ahead at Indy in the final is something I've never had that anywhere else.
That place, you either had it or you didn't. And certain guys throughout the years have had it. They rolled in there and they got that look in their eyes and they had it. And I'm still trying to get that look.
The pressure is on no matter what when you get there. I mean, everyone's fighting to get locked into the countdown for the championship. And I mean, everybody wants to win it. It's, you know, it's the biggest race of the season. I mean, everybody wants to win Indy.
You know, they always say that you can win a championship, but if you never won Indy, well, you better win Indy. And I've won both.
And of course, the big go right around the corner, very much on the minds of most everyone. But right now, Terry McMillan's crew, after that violent explosion, assessing damage here at the top end of the racetrack. And I can tell you, it is excessive. Let's get a word here with Terry. It looked like we were seeing flame up into the cockpit. First of all, you okay?
Yeah, I'm good, you know, nothing. It's just the feelings are hurt, you know. I mean, we're working so hard trying to get this thing figured out, and you know, the car got out there a little soft in the middle and then picked it back up, started to run really hard and charge, and then, man, all of a sudden it let go. It dropped something in the valve train on the intake side to have that kind of explosion and took the intake out, the blower and the injector, and everything's gone. But, you know, I mean, we're just going to have to go back and fix it and keep fighting this thing until we get it right. But, you know, we're not going to quit. The Amley Motor Oil team, man, we're diehards at this, and, you know, we're gonna do everything we can. You know, we just got to get it figured out and see what happens when we get to Indy.
Terry, your perseverance has been tested so much, but you go and you mention Indy. We may talk about the big go. If everything came into place and you won that, what would that day be like?
Man, first of all, you need an ambulance down there because I need CPR at the end of the track because it would be incredible. You know, just to get a round win or just to get a national event win in NHRA is certainly a huge, huge accomplishment. And to win Indy, I mean, that's the granddaddy of all of them, and that's what everybody remembers, that and the champion every year. So, you know, I mean, it would be huge. And, you know, we've been close to doing good there, but we just never really hit it right. And, you know, we're still trying to figure out how to run 70s right now, and those guys are running the 70s like it's every day of the week. And so we got to keep working at our game, but our perseverance will get us there. But if I ever win Indy, send the ambulance because I'm going to need it.
Thanks
guys.
That's good stuff, Terry McMillan. Well, while the cleanup continues, we wait next for Morgan Lucas, just the third race of his season, taking on Bob Vandergrift, who started today six rounds back of J.R. Todd. If he can go deep the next couple of events, perhaps Bob Vandergrift can make life interesting for that 10th spot in Top Fuel. Meanwhile, the work continues in Doug Colitta's pit. Seattle winner will take on Spencer Massey, twice a winner this season as well. That's a big-time matchup as we start looking forward to round two to Lucas Oil Nationals. Funny car driver Bob Bodie has had his most success at Brainerd International Raceway, getting his one and only win at the Lucas Oil Nationals back in 2010. Well, since then, the popular driver struggled just to make the field, heating things up during a qualifying run here last year and again on a Friday night pass this season in Chicago. Even though the fires look similar, the cause and effect couldn't have been more different. Bob breaks it down in this week's Traxxas Extreme Power Session.
In Brainerd 2013, we were running a head gasket like this. We pushed the head gasket and hurt the cylinder. It torched the block and the head, pushed all of that into the oil pan and dumped oil all over the body, the track, and made a huge fire. Destroyed lots of parts on that run, but we got in the show in 2013.
As we saw Bob explain, it was the head gasket that seals the cylinder head to the engine block and the individual cylinders that failed last year in Brainerd that caused the fire. In Chicago, it was a different gasket on the cylinder head that created that spectacular flame. Bob explains what happened and what they did to try and fix the problem.
In Chicago, we heard a valve cover gasket. It pushed the cylinder and it hurt a piston, so it took this piece and broke it open, dumped all the oil on the header, made a huge fire. It looked really, really bad. It wasn't as bad as our fire we had in Brainerd, but it ran well and got us down the track. We looked real hard at what was going on, and we added a sensor down here in the box, and it tells us when the pan pressure gets over 15 pounds. When it hits 15 pounds, it connects to the Leahy box that shuts the motor off and keeps you from doing and having the damage we had with that fire.
Fire is never a good thing, and it's obvious that some are worse than others. A lot of the times, it's not until you get back into the pits and start analyzing the cartilage that you truly realize the extent of the damage fire can cause. Doug Collette and his team had no problem containing the fire inside of the engine and out the headers, but the problem for Doug and the Mack Tools team was the body panel. It was ripped right off the side of that car. Various other pieces and parts rained down on the Brainerd International Raceway track. Safety Safari quick on the scene there to pick everything up. And John Kernan is back in the pits now for a Grime Boss Fix-It Pit Report.
And Dave, I think we've found out what happened. As you see, the side where the panel was ripped off, the whole panel didn't come off. It was just basically ripped in two. This is a Zeus fastener. They use these, put them through these holes to connect the body panels to the chassis of the car. And apparently one came loose, so all that pressure at over 300 miles an hour, the air pressure got underneath it and just basically ripped it, peeled it right off.
Back in the staging lanes, Cruz Pedregon waiting patiently for his matchup against Jack Beckman. Cruz, you say it's been a bit of a struggle this weekend. You are the crew chief, you are the driver. What have you had to overcome to get to this point?
Well, just the extreme wet conditions we've had. We've had water grains up in the just three triple digits, and then we've had it's a little bit of altitude here in Brainerd. In other words, it's we're up in 1,300 feet of altitude, so it's been a little challenge. But we just haven't had the car, the motor run real right here, so we're kind of in uncharted territories with our new cylinder heads and all that. We're still just when we think we can look at our old data, we were in new different kind of conditions. But you know, the good thing for that is we learned a lot. But it's all thrown out the window because today is a different day. It's a lot cooler, a lot more familiarity with what we have setup wise. So, if the car hits on all eight and doesn't scuff any pistons, it ought to go like crazy.
They will be towards the back of the funny car field, the seventh pair out. Stat guy.
Cruz's only Brainerd win came here in 1992. It was his first of five consecutive race wins, including the Big O Indy, on his way to his first championship. And I think John Force is still mad about that to this day.
Guaranteed still upset about that. Well, this Saturday night, under the lights, the world's fastest half mile, NASCAR's best drivers bump, bang, and battle with Chase Hopes hanging in the balance. 43 drivers battle, 16 advance, three races to go. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Bristol, presented by AutoZone, Saturday at 7 Eastern on ABC. Might be a few people upset after that race, too. Burn out of Morgan Lucas, and now Bob Vandergriff. For Bob, a unique opportunity to perhaps climb back in to the top 10. He finds himself six rounds back to J.R. Todd, but Mike, nine times, including today, Bob Vandergriff has had lane choice. In those eight previous times, he's only advanced hash brown one time. Got to get it together on race day.
And it's only the third time this season that we've seen Morgan Lucas out, but it hasn't been a good weekend for him so far. He did not make a full pass in qualifying. They were fighting an ignition issue that hit really hard in Q3. They did get it worked out in Q4, just enough to get down the track and get a little bit of data. Morgan says, though, they're pretty confident they're going to make a full pull here.
Well, they should probably be confident because Aaron Brooks also assists on that tune-up on that race car. And we just seen Richie Crampton set both ends of the track record in these conditions. So Bob Vandergriff will have his work cut out for him. He ran well in qualifying, but he didn't run great. Wasn't the consistent car that you need to get past the first round. Maybe that's been one of his problems this year. You need to run, run after run after run to get that consistency. But if it goes down the track, the thing does run well.
10-year anniversary for Morgan Lucas's start in Top Fuel, where he drove for Joe Amato, also won an alcohol dragster that day. This the only track on tour where he's won multiple races. He's on the start line first, and he's to the finish line as well. 378, 317 as Bob Vandergriff goes.
Bob.
376-0. That's now the track ET record. The second time it's been reset. The second time, and again, a losing effort.
Well, Bob Vandergriff was just flat late. Rich Crampton got beyond a whole shot. He had a decent reaction time, but Bob was definitely late. A 1:20 light. Morgan Lucas had over 0.05 of a second advantage off the starting line. The car was moving early before it started hurting the parts and pieces. Makes a nice run, but how about Bob Vandergriff? New track record, low ET, and he's going home.
We have one pair of dragsters left before we get into funny car. First pair out, we will see John Force and Bob Bodie. So, Jimmy, when the conditions are this different, what effect does that have on the funny car tune-up?
Well, the conditions are good, but the biggest concern is it's been a long time since we ran with the track this cool. So the main thing's just getting the primary right and, get by the tree without shaking, and then hopefully should be good.
Some of the crew chiefs guys telling me that the conditions are here for a 3-second run. They're just not sure they're going to go for it.
Well, and for what it's worth, John's 11 wins, the most at any one track, any one national event, all came with Austin Coyle. Wants to give that man, Jimmy Prock, a win here today in Brainerd. Take all that momentum on Indianapolis.
Want me to loosen him up?
The top fuel set to fire in just a moment. We'll wrap up with Tony Schumacher up against Leah Pritchett. Tony, of course, making NHRA history here in 2005 when he went 337.58 mile an hour in the quarter mile on that day. Gary Gerald.
With Morgan Lucas as he pops out of there, that's got to be satisfying. 378 after ignition problems, 10-year anniversary, this place, all good.
You know what? The first race I ever had here in top fuel, I was hitting the train qualifying, and I came up first round and missed it, and I got my butt chewed up by Wayne Dupuis, my crew chief at the time, and justifiably so. But then when you sit up there with the oil down like that, you get all these nerves built up. I guess they just caught it right, and Bobby is a great racer, it's a great team, and I know he's got some exciting stuff happening in the future, but for Lucas Oil, Protect Harvest, and this whole team, we're really happy to just go rounds.
How about that first win at this racetrack? What kind of memories does that hold for you, Morgan?
Oh, so many. So many that probably weren't sober enough really to talk about, but we just had a lot of fun. And again, you know what? Just having my parents there would be great. I can't wait to have my wife and son out here. That's going to make all this that much better, and just really blessed to be in this situation.
And we're going to see Morgan at more events as we get into the countdown of the championship. Hey,
and, of course, the continuing question for the man Morgan just beat is, what's the future of Bob Vandergriff Racing going to hold? We know Bob's going to step out of the cockpit. There are plans for two-car operation. Larry Dixon, Dave Conley, it's all up in the air right now, Gary.
And with Bob Vandergriff as he studies that time slip, I know that's got to be painful. You run such a great lap when you throw down a 76 here. How do you digest? How do you accept that?
Well, you can't. You know, you feel bad. I just did a bad job driving. You can make some excuses, but the bottom line is the car ran great. The crew gave me a great car. C&J Energy Services car just set the track record, I think I heard, and the driver just did a bad job driving, so there's no excuses. It's on me. Just got to get my act together. I haven't been doing a good job lately.
Now, speaking of getting your act together, big changes we understand in store for you and your team for next season. How much can you share at this point, Bob?
Well, we're just working on improving our program. Like I said, we've got great partners with C&J Energy Services and all their companies, and we're looking to make our program bigger and better to where we can compete with, you know, the DSRs and Alan Johnson's team and the great teams out here, and that's the direction we're headed for next year. I'm excited about transitioning to the owner role. Obviously, I'm going to do better at that than driving here lately, so hopefully we can be more successful with me out of the car and just working on making the program better.
Is there a timetable when we'll be able to get confirmation on will it be a Dave Conley or a Larry Dixon as the two drivers for Bob Vandergriff?
Yeah, we're working on that right now. You know, we got meetings set up all next week trying to finalize a lot of stuff. And, you know, best case scenario, a couple of weeks. But you know how that is. You're at the mercy of other people when you start making those decisions. But sooner the better for me.
Glad you're staying in the sport.
Thank you.
Second bad opinion, Gary Gerald, for sure. Leah Pritchett, Tony Schumacher, final pair, round one, top fuel. Well, in what's been an interesting first round here at the Lucas Oil Nationals, thanks to Bob Vandergriff's loss, it sort of cleared up the waters a little bit in the top 10. In fact, you started Doug Kalitico all the way down to Richie Crampton. 1 through 9 are now locked into the countdown to the championship. J.R. Todd will take a 6-round lead over Vandergriff to Indianapolis, and he's probably going to qualify.
Yeah, even though it's not official, it's pretty much official right now based on those numbers. But right now you're looking at Tony Schumacher. Talked about numbers, running that great 337 mile per hour speed. Tony has had a very good car this year. I know I keep saying it, but consistently. Now, one of the problems he did mention a few races ago was the fact that they were losing first rounds. The reason was because they were playing defense instead of offense if they're racing a lesser car. Okay. This is a track you can't do that, and they know that right now. Mike Green, Neil Stroud, they've changed that thought process, and they've gotten aggressive with the tune-up. What that does is it doesn't create that situation where they go into that tire shake early because the car is too weak and doesn't have the wheel spin.
Stat guy, Dave, you mentioned that 337 pass by Tony Schumacher a couple years back. While I asked Alan Johnson what the 1,000-foot numbers were, he said 378, 322, because fans always want to know.
Of course, Alan Johnson was his crew chief when he made that run. Right now, it's Mike Green. .77-8, 324 miles an hour, no problem for the Don's son, Tony, who's in round number 2.
Well, they definitely weren't soft on that Army car. You saw Leah, boy, she really hiked the front end and then set it back down. It was pretty much side by side up to that point, and then something goes wrong with the engine. No problems for the Army car as Tony Schumacher goes right down the racetrack and into the second round.
The Lucas Oil ladder for that second stanza shows Antron Brown picking his lane over Larry Dixon. How about Steve Torrance and Morgan Lucas, both out of the bottom half of the field. Then Doug Coletta, Sean Langdon. Langdon against Tony Schumacher. That's a primetime monster matchup. Well, coming up, the first three pair of funny car include the 16-time champion, John Force, who's won 11 times here, Ron Capps, who's won the last two at Brainerd International Raceway, and Matt Hagen taking on Chad Head. Matt trying to keep a consistent race car qualifying into the countdown. Well, John Force, 2007, the 11th of his wins here came against another legend, Kenny Bernstein. But all 11 of those, as we mentioned before, were with that man, Austin Coyle. Can John Force get Jimmy Crocker win here today in Brainerd? Funny car is up next. The NHRA Meliello Drag Racing Experience at the Zoo. Many have heard about it. If you've never had a chance to go back there and live it, you gotta come to Brainerd International Raceway with Lucas Oil Nationals just for that.
There's no place like it, Dave.
And when we went back there yesterday, there was many places we could have gone, many floats we could have ridden doing that ALS Ice Bucket Challenge, but boy, they certainly know how to have a good time back there.
I'm hungry.
200 acres back there camping. There is some quiet spots. You want to bring the family, you can go over to a safe environment. Otherwise, you can just go back there and have some fun. The Lucas Oil Ladder, John Forrest, number one qualifier for the 151st time. Tommy Johnson Jr. going to try to make life tough on Tim Wilkerson and holding on to that 10th and final spot in the points.
The other side is our Harley-Davidson marquee matchup. Fast Jack Beckman really needs to get a win over Cruz Pedregon, but Cruz going to have something for him.
John Forrest kicking things off with Bob Bodie, who won here in 2010. Whoa, John had a little pedal there. Gets his car to cooperate first, 418, 316 miles an hour. Bob Bodie now 0-11, racing John Force.
And with Antron Brown, who just a moment ago watched his teammate Tony Schumacher advance. Antron, you're facing Larry Dixon in the second round, number two in the points. We know that the last 4 years, the number one seed in the countdown went on to win the championship. So how much emphasis is being put on getting past Doug Coletta into number one?
I mean, that's what we're focused on right now. We're taking it one round at a time. And, John, we're giving everything we got, man. Doug's right there in front of us, and he's dangling that bacon, man. But we still got our work cut out for us. This track's going to be some mine shaft conditions this weekend. So our Macco boys, we're just going to keep our head down and throw everything we got every round and see if we can get those extra 20 points. That means a lot for that championship.
All right, thanks, Antron.
I love bacon.
Who doesn't?
Dangle some bacon out in front of me. I try to do that as well as you take a look at Antron Brown's opponent in round number two. Some guy named Larry Dixon. You might have heard of him before. He's the second winningest Top Fuel racer of all time.
John Forrest had to pedal it, but you get the round victory against Bob Bowie.
That, you know, the crew chief, they make the bucks, the crew chief, Jimmy Prock, and these guys. And they make the big power, and they make us drivers look good. But every now and then a driver gets to show his stuff. And ain't nobody better than that than me. There's a lot of good drivers out here, and they can do that. Robert Hyde and a lot of the guys, Wilkerson and Warsham, it goes back to our old days, the Petragons. That's how we grew up. But, man, when you can look your crew chief and say, hey, I finally bailed this, because you got to know that when it rattles like that, it's not sometimes it's overpowering the tire. And if you pedal it, you ain't going to save it because the tire's gone. You got to get out and wait a half a second. But when it does that, because it's so cold, you know this track is killer bite. And the minute you feel it touch, I'm going back to tell my girls right now, Robert already knows, but you get after that thing and it'll go. And then you feel like a man again. You feel like a race car driver.
See you, John.
That's what I'm talking about. It's me fired.
Where do you want
him,
Timmy?
Right there, Skip.
Are they running right now?
Well, anytime we come to Brainerd, that means football's right around the corner. And Monday, ESPN brings you Monday Night Football preseason coverage with a great game. It's the Redskins, Robert Griffin Jr. III, looks to bounce back. Johnny Manziel and the Browns. I mean, who knows where this one's going to go?
That will probably be the highest rated preseason game, I guarantee you.
Monday night, 8 o'clock Eastern on ESPN. That's when you can check out that Browns versus Redskins game. Next pair, when we get things going again, will be Ron Capps, who can clinch his way into the countdown with a round one win over Jeff Ferren. Of course, Ron Capps, four times a winner here at Brainerd, including the last 2 years. It was very adventuresome, though, in 2013 for the
driver, you hate when this happens. Qualifying, you blow the body completely off the car, and it was a huge explosion. Not just a little pop, not just a little bang, a big-time explosion. Ron Capso, he's been through this. He was able to bounce back. Ron Tobler gave him a great tune-up, and they were able to get the trophy in the final round, the fourth of Ron's career.
You always got to love it when you are the last man standing to take on the little man at the end of the day.
I like drag racing because of the one-on-one competition. When you get suited up, you're getting ready to get in the car. It's like a old-school Western draw. It's you against that other guy, and especially if it's the final round. Man, there's just everybody's focused on two cars, two drivers. And it's the ultimate, and who's the badass out there?
And that is why Cruz Pedregon loves drag racing here at the Lucas Oil Nationals. Race 17 to 24 on the NHRA Meliello Drag Racing Series. You know who else loves drag racing as we get set for Ron Capps and Jeff Arend? Top Fuel's Clay Milliken does, but not loving it quite so much today. Clay Milliken taking to the Twitter airwaves today. This is a tough game. Sometimes you don't get to play. Suffered a DNQ here this weekend.
That is, did not qualify, and I can relate to that. I had 13 in my career. Had Lewis Bloom check that out for me, and 13 times, I guarantee you, I was pretty miserable on Sunday.
That stinks, and that's a fact for Clay Milliken. It's his 18th career DNQ.
Right now, you're looking at Ron Capps, the second winningest Funny Car driver here in Brainerd with four wins. He's only seven behind John Force, who just ran ahead of him.
A couple years will clear that up.
He can make that up, can he?
There's Jeff Arend, who was in the doghouse here at Brainerd last year. Had that little episode back there in that campground. But Big Jim Dunn back after the colon cancer surgery. Glad to hear he's feeling better. Says by Indianapolis he'll be 100%. For Ron Capps, though, big moment for him. He can officially clinch his spot into the countdown with a round one win here.
Yeah, but you know, the track conditions are obviously very tight with this rain delay that we've had between these two cars. It's going to be not any looser.
3 hour rain delay.
Yeah, 3 hour rain delay. So the key is, it's still going to be like the first cars out. We saw John Force had to back pedal his car. It's going to be just as tight. You're going to have to get that wheel speed going, because if you don't, it will go into tire shake.
Top end. You saw Caps have to pedal.
Wow. And look at the run.
4.11.2.
Back pedaling.
That thing, if it had gone on all eight the entire way without a pedal, what would that have been? Wow.
I mean, obviously it was a great job. I mean, Ron, watch the left side of your screen. He's going to just flip that throttle really quick. Boom, right there. I'll tell you, and still in a 4.11. That's a pretty impressive run there. Jeff Arend, left side of your screen. He didn't have any problems other than down track, the cylinder went out and started pushing over his one center.
Good job.
And Ron Capps was able to drive around him. Good job.
Ron Capps now officially clinched into the countdown of the championship. Now can get on to the business of trying to win Brainerd International Raceway, the Lucas Oil Nationals, for a fifth time. Well, that'll bring us now to his DSR teammate in the Dodge, Matt Hagen, up against the Toyota of Chad Head. Matt Hagen riding a nice little streak right now, five races in a row without a first round loss. It's the best streak he's had in 2014. And there's Chad Head. The last time we saw him race was in Norwalk, Ohio. Welcome back, Chad.
Ron Capps pops out of there. 4.11 with a pedal job. How sweet's that?
Well, I was just gonna tell it hurt. It hurt, first of all. It shook so hard. We saw Forrest do it in front of us before the last rain, and I know what that's like. And in conditions like this, you just don't see these unless we get later in the year to Reading or places where it'll hold a world record run. And that's the first time in a while where I pedaled a car that far out, and it lifted the front end up, and it was unbelievable. I just hung on and hoped it went semi straight. And it's fun when a wind light comes on, but man, when it shakes like that and you pedal, you don't see for about a second and a half or 2 seconds. Not so good when you're going 280 miles an hour, but great job of the Napa guys, and go to the next round. This place has always been great to me, Gary, so let's see what happens.
Thanks, Ron.
Thanks.
How about this for unique, Mike? All the drivers, 1 through 8, they qualified in that order. That is the run order of round one in Funny Car. Huh. This is the number 3 qualifier in Matt Hagen.
Okay, John Forrest, you're going to see the bolt pedal right there, and then Ron Capp, same thing. And remember, that is all about the wheel speed. Now, the one good thing is the track is so tight, you don't have to, if the car was to slightly get loose from that tire shake, you don't have to get as much to get it under control, because it is tight, and it will grip back up and hook up, even with that 10,000 horsepower being applied to those big Goodyear sleds.
What kind of changes could Dickie Venables have made to that car, and did Matt Hagan pay attention to those first two runs? Chad Head's going to try to keep him honest here. Goes A to B, 4018.
That's what happens when you don't shake.
Wow.
Well, you said you wonder what Dickie Venables is going to do. Well, it was obvious he's going to get after it early, because that's what you have to do to get that wheel speed going. And boy, did they get after it. No tire shake. Ron Capps probably would have made a similar pass had he not have to backpedal. Matt Hagan, he didn't have to backpedal at all. And wow, right down Broadway and makes a great pass.
I'll tell you what Dickie Venables just did for Matt Hagan. He allowed him to tie the Brainerd International track record with a 4.018 second pass. But I don't think we're done. Just yet. Here's the quickest of the weekend. You can see by a bunch.
And funny, it's just, you know, those three guys that have ran.
Boy, look at the eyes as Matt popped out and got the information there. He's focused.
Oh, man. Hey, I mean, yeah, good ET slip will do that.
Tommy Johnson Jr., Tim Wilkerson. Let's talk a little bit about the peak power rankings according to Mike Dunn.
Well, we
one,
see.
Two, and three, one, two, and three, and have all advanced.
There you go. The three pairs that went down. John Forrest, Ron Capps, and Matt Hagan. I'm looking pretty good right now. That's why I wanted to put them in at that point, because it doesn't happen very often. But obviously, John Forrest has been on a tear. Ron Capps always does well here. And Matt Hagan has had a very good car, as indicated by that pass.
Wow, one, two, and three in qualifying. One, two, and three in the peak power rankings, and all have advanced already in the first, second, and third pair.
Doesn't happen very often.
No. Tommy Johnson Jr., this is a driver in the Make-A-Wish car that can also clinch his way into the countdown to the championship with a round one win here. First guy he ever raced here at Brainerd International Raceway, 1990, some guy named Dick LeHay.
Yeah.
But to do that, he's got to beat Wilkerson now. Big moment for him in the points.
Well, you know, we talked about Tommy and the fact that that car runs so well in the heat. He did it this weekend because we had hot conditions in qualifying. One session, I believe session three, he went right down the track and ran either low or very close to it. So we know he has a hot weather combination. He also, though, has ran this season well when the conditions are good. But these conditions are very good. And right now he's got to do the same thing as his teammate Ron Capps and Matt Hagan did, and not shake the tires.
Remember, Wilkerson talked to both Jimmy Prock and I believe Mike Neff about how to get this Ford moving in the right direction. That wasn't it for Timmy. 4.097. Tommy Johnson Jr. has advanced out of the number four qualifying spot. He has now clinched his way into the top 10.
Well, Tim Wilkerson, he got into that tire shake and then got the tires loose. And it, if you take a look at it, it just started rattling. He caught it quick, went back on it, but it then went up into tire smoke when it. And you can see what happened. The car just wasn't really settled down. Even when the track's this good, the car still has to be relatively planted before you go back on the throttle. Otherwise, it just wants to kick the rear up like it did there.
You should have seen Sean Langdon's eyes light up when he heard that Matt Hagan ran that 401, because Top Fuel is coming up in just a little bit for their second attack on the track. And Sean, when you're going up against a guy like Tony Schumacher, you hear the numbers that Hagan just ran. What's going through your mind as you guys get ready with this car?
Well, you know, obviously running Tony, that U.S. Army team, they've been running well as of late, and we're trying to knock them down. We want to hold on to that three spot in the points, entering the countdown. But, you know, after qualifying with the weather conditions, how it's changed for today, it's cold, it's tight, the track's good. So as a driver, you got to be cautious and aware of it. You know, it's gonna try to grip that tire, and hopefully you can make enough power and keep the wheel speed up to where it's not going to shake the tire. So, you know, obviously Alan Johnson, Brian Hughes have been doing a great job with this car turning around the last few races, and we got a competitive race car again, and that's all I need as a driver.
Now you go to Indy where you won last year. How big a deal would carrying some momentum from here into there be?
Well, it's huge. Indy, you know, obviously the biggest race of the year, and I think the toughest part of Indy is the week leading up to it. There's so much hype with it all, and you know, a lot of media stuff. We have the tracks to shoot out, you know, thing that we do downtown, and the Eric Medlin golf tournament, and You know, just a lot of buildup for that race. So it's a special race. I know it's a special race for Alan and his family as well. And coming off the win last year, you know, it's a special place for me. So we have a lot of friends and family come out. But, you know, with this Alan Abbey team, we just want to get that win and, you know, have that hot streak heading into the countdown.
Speaking of the Traxxas Nitro Shootouts, voting is now open for those drivers not yet qualified. Head to NHRA's Facebook page. Mark Lyle has to make a tough decision here and says, guys, we just simply can't go. We got moisture. You know what else we got? That 10th spot in funny car heating up. Remember, Wilkerson just got beat.
Yep.
That opens the door for Jack Beckman.
How much you got, Cal?
That's a slip right here. It's slippery, y'all. It came real quick, Graham.
Well, we'll see what happens here as Mark Lyle's got his crew on it. We'll take it to the top end, though. Find out what's going on with Gary Gerald.
Well, we wanted to check in with Jeff Aram because we hadn't seen him on the Western Swing. Of course, big Jim Dunn out with some surgery. And how good is life to get back on the racetrack? And how's big Jim been doing?
You know, great to get back. And, you know, Jim, within a few hours of operation, was already talking about race car stuff. So over the last few weeks, he's got better and better. I went and saw him at the shop and looked at him. He looked like 5 to 10 years younger. So he was dying to get our Grind Boss car back out here again. You know, Indy, of course, is a big race for him. And this is like our test session. So he's doing really well. The rain pissed him off a little bit, so he's still big Jim.
Well, it's great to see you out here. And it's also nice to see you popping out of the top the way you're supposed to, as opposed to a year ago when someone broke his foot in the zoo.
What idiot did that?
I don't know, but we're going to find out. We'll get to the bottom of that story.
You get the lowdown on that.
Thanks, Jeff.
Thank you.
In the staging lanes, the cover now on the car of Alexis DeJoria. But Tommy DeLago, I've watched you over the last couple minutes. As these conditions change, you go back and forth to the car. As the crew chief, what kind of changes do you make in these conditions?
Well, you just try to make sure that you didn't forget anything, because we had to come up here earlier to make our first round run, then go back to the trailer. Yeah, I've got a list up here that I mark off what I did, but then I second guess it. Well, I might as well just check everything that again, make sure I did everything I was supposed to do, just because it has to be so perfect to go down in these conditions.
I saw that list that was in your pocket. I was wondering if that was a to-do list. Is that something that you do every race weekend or just when conditions are like this?
No, I do that every run because you can forget something. So we always want to make some changes, or we have some ideas for the next run. So I just make a list and I cross it off. That's the easiest. I know it's kind of archaic, but it works.
Whatever works. And bad news right now, guys, the cars have been pushed back through the staging lanes.
Well, here's Tim Wilkerson bringing his car back into the pits. This team knows that now they get to put it away before Indianapolis. And what that does, them being eliminated in round one, is opens up the door for a countdown critical driver by the name of Jack Beckman. Beckman starting the day less than two rounds behind Tim Wilkerson. And he is still going forward here today. Big first round matchup coming up against Cruz Pedregon. But Jack Beckman, part of a trivia question. We'll let you chew on these, this question for a little bit. Can you name the funny car drivers who have made the top 10 in points every year of the countdown? Sounds easy, might not be, but think about it for a little bit. We'll have the answer for you in just a little bit. It's Funny Car. We're trying to keep moving forward. And after Funny Car and Pro Stock, back to Top Fuel, where a big-time matchup sits in the second stanza. As Tony Schumacher gets set to take on Sean Langdon. Both Indy winners, both champions, both love winning.
All sports have fans. They're crazy for their sport, and they show it. Football fans paint their faces and bodies. Then there's the fan crazy for tennis or golf. They love the sport. They seldom display much emotion at all. Drag racing has incredible super fans. For drag racing, the pinnacle is the Zoo, a city of race fans equipped with many special facilities, a host of contests, lovely accommodations, lovely people, and a nightly parade complete with floats. These are serious fans and fun lovers. So football has painted bodies and faces, while tennis and golf enjoy dignity. But give me the Zoo. Party. Party again. Parade. Watch the runs. And party. It's how the Zoo rolls.
Well struck, Paul Page. course, plenty of excitement going on in the 200-acre campground surrounding Brainerd International Raceway. Plenty of action here at the Lucas Oil Nationals in the pits as you watch the warm-up of Sean Langdon in anticipation of a big-time second-round matchup with Tony Schumacher. Yet, back in the Tim Wilkerson camp, there is dejection and second-guessing.
A dejected Tim Wilkerson back in the pit now. His day is done. And Tim, with as tight as it is between you and Jack for that final countdown spot, what is the pressure, the tension like right now?
I'm just irritated with myself. We didn't do a better job than that. Just really irritated. That track like that, you ought to be able to run what Matt Hagen ran there in front of me in 01. I mean, you ought to be able to do that. And we just missed it, I guess. I really thought it had enough power in it to do that. And it shook bad. So we'll go back to the drawing board and figure this out. But we gotta know how to go out on a track like that. Usually we've been pretty good at that. And I tuned her up. I really thought it was going to haul ass, but it didn't.
Well, we'll see him in Indy.
So what will be going through that man's head over the next week and a half? Well, Jeff Gordon just picked up his third win of the year, retook the point lead away from Dale Earnhardt Jr. in Michigan. And now, next Saturday night, under the lights at the world's fastest half mile, NASCAR's best drivers bump, bang, and battle with Chase Hopes hanging in the balance. 43 drivers battle, 16 advance, three races to go. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Bristol, presented by AutoZone, Saturday at 7 on ABC. Well, that will bring us now to Alexis DeJoria and Courtney Force. Courtney in much the same position as Ron Capps and Tommy Johnson Jr. can officially punch her ticket into the countdown to the championship with a round one win here.
Well, and they're both in the same position as far as going down the racetrack as we've seen in the previous cars that have attempted it. Now, the good news is lanes seem to be very even. I failed to mention Chad Head went a 408 in that loss to Matt Hagen's 401 because it was so fantastic. 408 would have been pretty much beat anybody else in this round up to this point. So we know the track conditions are very good.
What happened to Robert Height and Bob Tasker? We saw those cars get fired before Mark Lyle had to shut them down.
They are allowed to go back and service a car enough to get it to the end of the session. So they're going to have to. But let's go back and take a look at Alexis' burnout. We've seen this before where she goes in the throttle and basically fogs that whole right bank, like almost all four cylinders out. We even seen at one point where it did that and the back end washed out considerably, but stayed nice and straight. Shouldn't affect the run at all whatsoever. The key is going to be, like they've said, get the wheel speed going early. We know once it gets going out there, that track will pretty much take whatever you can give it through the middle.
Also, what's at stake? No female driver has won three races in a funny car. Both of these women have two. Courtney did not punch a ticket just yet. 4:01 flat. Wow. That's the now track record elapsed time courtesy of Tommy DeLago. 4.010. Look at that speed, 317.64 miles an hour.
That was a pass. You take a look at Courtney. It looked like they got the wheel speed going too fast because it looked like that thing spun before she got to the shake zone real early. Right there, yep. Long before they got to that shake zone. She's got the wheel speed going too fast, right up in smoke. No problem for Alexis. 401, her ragtime to a 179. She's now the worst. She's going to be on a hole shot by John Force in the last race. That 179, I don't care if you are running 401s, you're not going to win today.
Matt Hagen goes 401.8, doesn't even get lane choice.
How
thanks to Alexis
that?
DeJoria.
Way to go, boss. Way to go.
And Matt, you heard the number that Alexis just ran. You ran a smoking pass, but you don't get lane choice. Your thoughts?
Man, I tell you, that's tough out there. I mean, to run that fast and that quick and still not have lane choice just shows you how good the track is. But I tell you what, it makes the window a lot smaller. A lot of guys are shaking out there and having to pedal the race car. So Dickie Venables did a great job out there, you know, making the calls to get this car down to the other end. But it was a fun ride to hang on to. So hopefully, you know, that's going to be a tough ride over there, you know, battling with my old crew chief, Tommy DeLago and Alexis. But we want to put this Mopar Express Lane Rocky Boots funny car in a winner's circle. So let's see what we can do today.
Helmet comes off, cap goes on, mellow yellow goes in the hand. Wow, new track record. Put us in the seat. What'd that feel like?
Excellent. There's a few good cars back there still, but I hope it holds up. Wow, third time's the charm for us. Thank God we got to make a run. I almost double-stepped it against my friend Courtney, but luckily I didn't, and we got the run, and we got the win, and we're going to second round, and feels damn good to be back. So thank you, guys. Thanks to my team. They've done a hell of a job, Tommy and Glenn. Man, you guys are amazing. Thank you so much.
This is going to be special. A pair of 401s head-to-head second round. Hagen, DeJoria.
And why is that third time a charm? First round losses the first two times she came to BIR as a professional. Big moment now, Jack Beckman, Cruz Pedregon.
You heard Alexis talk about almost double-stepping it. That's why the 179 light. She started to go down in the throttle, realized the light hadn't come on, so she basically relaxed, and then the light did come on, and boom, you're late.
Here is the situation. Jack Beckman can earn 20 points with a round win here. Get within a round of Tim Wilkerson in that battle for the 10th and final position. Del Worsham will be coming up in the 8th pair. Of course, everybody now taking selfies, maybe with the exception of Mike Dunn, including Jack Beckman. He must recognize John
Cute
Force.
Couple, huh? Yeah.
Selfies, God, okay. Well, right now, he's just gonna be paying attention to himself at getting a good reaction time and getting down the racetrack. Obviously, you're gonna have to go out there and make the kind of run and not get into that tire shake that some of the teams have been going through.
Let's answer the trivia question. Can you name the funny car drivers who've made the top 10 in points every year of the countdown? I know the stat guy can.
The answer would be four drivers. Here are the names.
Only four.
Only four. Wow. Caps, Hyde, Force, and Beckman. But as you saw, Dave, we did some math. The guy was had the best car in the regular season on average in terms of a point.
These four guys
is Ron Capps, but he's never won a championship.
Wow. Guess what Jack Beckman's done? One from the bottom side of the qualified ladder. The first guy to do that. And yes, he helped himself and his entire Don Schumacher organization out in a big way.
Boy, he needed that win. Well, Cruz Pedregon, the car didn't move. I don't think he had a cylinder. I know he had a cylinder out down track. It might have been at the head of the throttle because the car just did not move early. Fast Jack Beckman made a nice run. Not a great run in that right-hand lane, but obviously that 411, when your competition's got a cylinder out and moving over towards center, is good enough, even though it looked like he was starting to push a head gasket out down track too.
Well, in the interest of fair reporting, the track record ET that was replaced here today was set by Jack Beckman, who now moves within a round of Tim Wilkerson and is still racing today. Guess who's waiting for him, though, in the second round? His own teammate, Ron Capps. Well, in Pro Stock, there is a battle going on for 10th as well, as Jonathan Graves, been in that position, doesn't find himself there right now, Jamie.
Jonathan Gray getting suited up as he will be in the first pair out in his first round matchup against Vincent Nobile. But Jonathan, let's talk points. Right now you're not in the top 10. You weren't even planning on doing the full season though. How much do the points weigh on you?
Well, at this point in the game, we've come to a situation where we have to go rounds. We have to. If we want any shot at all at getting back in there, we have to go rounds. We got to bear down and we got to go rounds. So we'll just see what happens.
Now it's time.
Del Worsham, currently ninth in the championship point battle funny car ranks, will be in action momentarily, and he is going up against, and I'm fumbling with my papers here, trying to figure out who he is going up against. He's going to go against Tony Pedregon. It only took me a few extra seconds to figure that out. Jack Beckman, how much new life have you just breathed into this team?
I'm not sure I've breathed. Unlike Houston, where I won, I didn't hit the garbage cans turning off the track. The fire windows in these cars, little round circular plexiglass windows, lit up early in the run. It pushed a head gasket out. Qualifying, you shut off. It's race day. You got to stay on it. I'm thinking Cruz is definitely going to outrun this. Our car was wounded. Our wind light came on. I'm like, now I got to get it off the track without putting oil on the track. We can't afford to give away any more points. That was huge. Now we know we can take this battle to Indy no matter what happens. But I got to tell you, don't come this far with this Valiant car and not want to close the deal.
Thank you. Now what will happen with the ninth place in points, Del Worsham. He is up right now against Tony Pedregon. Tony in his 900th round of racing when you combine Top Fuel and Funny Car, and just the second time in 2014, the Wix Filters driver has lane choice.
And he's taking the left-hand lane like everybody else has, but the key here for Tony Pedregon, he only made two qualifying passes. He ran 4.11 in that Friday night session, which at the time was good enough for third or fourth. Ended up in the number eight spot. Dell, trying to get in the top half, ended up number nine. Dell, just like Tim Wilkerson, just like Jack Beckman, really needs this round win.
Therapeutic weekend for Del Worsham, spent down in the San Diego area, junior drag racing with his daughters Caitlin and Madeline. But now it's all about business and Brainerd. Big flash of flame, that's all it takes. The yellow fellas give Del Worsham a 407-4 car and a round win. It's John Oberhofer that makes the tuning calls on that machine.
Well, Dell Worsham and that DHL team have been proving every time they went down the racetrack. They did struggle in qualifying on Friday, came back and finally got it together. You saw the backfire from Tony Pedregon on the right side of your screen. Dell, though, does make his best run of the weekend. It's probably an easier thing to do because the track conditions were so good, but give them credit. It went down the racetrack, what a lot of teams weren't able to do, and advanced to the second round. Nice job.
So the points up to the moment in that battle for 10th, as you see Dell Worsham is now 52 points clear of Tim Wilkerson. Jack Beckman, still racing, is within one round. So a moment of pause for Dell Worsham, the latter looking forward to round number two that is still missing one of its round two combatants. That's because of the Robert Hyde, Bob Tascabert being pushed back. John Force, Dell Worsham, very interesting. Caps Beckman as he continues to move forward. And then the battle of the 401 racers.
Matt Hagen, 401, and doesn't have lane joy. That's crazy.
Well, back in the pits, they have already got the John Force Castrol GTX Thrash underway. When he comes back, he will race the other fellas, the DHL driver, Dell Worsham, plus Pro Stock will come your way. And included in Pro Stock, big news perhaps on the way for Dave Conley, who in 2004 beat Greg Anderson to win the first time ever in Pro Stock. Dave is certainly one of the best. And is he moving on?
Yeah.
Pushing Nitro next year? Details to come.
The Lucas Oil NHRA Nationals is brought to you by the U.S. Army. Some are driven by expectations. Some defy them. Find your career at goarmy.com/defy. McDonald's, I'm loving it. And the Wyndham family of brands. More hotels than anyone else in the world.
This is the calm before the storm back in the Brainerd Zoo here at Brainerd International Raceway. The weekend stop for the NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series and the Lucas Oil Nationals. But that is Dell Worsham, who's standing by with Gary Gerald.
Dell, after just one round win the last five events, how much of a favor did you just do for you and your team?
Yeah, it was a huge favor. It's no secret, you know, Jack Beckman and Tim Wilkerson ourselves, we're in a very tight race here to make the countdown. And Cruz Pedregon's right in front of us, you know. So watching him go out, watching Jack win, watching Tim go out, we just got to keep pace with some people out here. And DHL Toyota Camry, Redline Oil, Champion Spark Plugs, you know, we got it done. You know, it was nerve-wracking, in and out of the car, waiting around. And, you know, like I said, I've been doing this 24 years, and it doesn't get any easier.
Take a deep breath and savor.
I will. Look forward to the next round.
Thanks.
Of course, just a moment ago, we talked about the calm before the storm back in the zoo. It's always calm during the day, but at night, who knows what comes out. But they've got a lot of very unique contraptions back there. If you can dream it, you can build it. You can bring it here and have fun with it.
They got a lot of nice stuff back there.
Check that out.
Jeez.
You got animals galore here. Oh, wow, you smudged the lens. Nice job, Fido.
I hope that was slobber.
That cleaned up. No problem at all. The Pro Stock Ladder, presented by Lucas Oil. Alan Johnson, number one for the 36th time. A great matchup between Vincent Nobile and Jonathan Gray. Jonathan, a countdown critical driver. That's how it kicks off today.
Other side of the ladder, I'm looking at Erica Enders. Good to see her back after two race hiatus. Still having the points lead, going up against Dave River. Both her and Dave Conley can win their first round matchup. It could be a race between nemesis.
One of the questions about the Gray Motorsports cars, considering that Shane and Dave Conley have already clinched their way into the countdown of the championship, why isn't Jonathan Gray, especially when you take a look at the fact that this guy is money leaving the Christmas tree? But both Dave and Shane looked at me and said, there is more than just leaving the starting line, and he's still a work in progress.
Well, and I'm sure they're talking about, you know, keeping the car, you know, in the center of the groove, hitting your shift points, which is very critical. And we're talking just, I mean, if you're 100 RPM off on those shift points, it can really kill a lot of elapsed time. You take a look at the points here, Jonathan Gray, about two rounds out of from Greg Anderson, that number 10 spot. But Greg Anderson's been running very well. It's not going to be easy for Jonathan. Now we're going to take in the fact the conditions are much better than the Pro Stock cars have seen all weekend. 2,000 feet better. So that 661 low elapsed time is going to get obliterated this round.
Vincent already qualified in the countdown. Could have tire shake as well. Oh!
Hang on.
Jonathan Gray crosses the center line. It looked like Vincent was in trouble first. Both cars eventually developed it. And because Jonathan Gray crosses the center line, Vincent moves on with a 772. at the time they started hitting third gear, it looked like you hold on.
Getting loose, yeah. Johns was uncharacteristically late, but you see there, boy, it made that nice move. Well, I shouldn't say nice, but quick move over towards the center. Watch the right side of your screen. Once these cars start moving around, there's not much downforce on them, and they get loose very, very quickly. And both of those drivers had that happen to them, and unfortunately for Jonathan Gray, he took it right across the center line for an automatic disqualification.
Second round of Top Fuel coming up. Larry Dixon and Antron Brown will kick it off. And Larry, while Antron's worried about trying to catch Doug Coletta for the number one position in the points, other people are wanting to get into the countdown. You're just here to race for a Wally. What's that like?
Yeah, just racing for the trophies and the cash. I mean, that's I guess that's probably like it was in the old days. You know, we're up here. I mean, obviously, it's a great car we're racing. And, you know, we lucked out when we beat him a few races back at Denver. You're not going to beat him again being lucky. We got to go out there and earn it this time.
LD with three wins at Brainerd, one with Allen Abbey, two with the Snake. Now trying to get Bob Vandergriff Racing a win.
Check in with Jonathan Gray. Got out of the car, a lot of emotion. How tough is that race surface to handle right now?
Well, Gary, as far as I'm concerned, it's not safe out there right now. Thing was going fine. You know, put it in third gear, and it just took a hard right. And for no apparent reason. And I just don't think it's, in my opinion, I just don't think it's safe out there.
And in a countdown critical situation that you're in, this makes it doubly painful, I'm sure.
It does. Absolutely it does. But, you know, what do you do? Go on to the next one, I guess.
All right, thanks.
Johnny, we just heard from Jonathan saying he didn't think it was safe out there. We saw your reaction from here when you saw him get across the line. Just overall, what do you think?
Well, we do this every time when the track's real cold. We don't spray for Pro Stock down track, you know. And they do it every time. And I don't know why that they can't get it through their head. But, you know, we're just lucky. Just then, Jonathan didn't wreck. Vincent didn't wreck his car. But that's not drag racing when you got to do that kind of crap. So, as you can see, they're spraying now. So, maybe it'll be safe now.
His son Shane is coming up next as he takes on V Gaines.
We noticed the sprayers were out and we saw it go right behind Johnny right there.
Well, here's the issue. There's two types of tracks that you want for two different classes, the field classes and the pro stock. The field classes, you don't want the glued down track because it wants to pull the rubber off of the tires, and that becomes an unsafe situation.
And you
situation.
Got plenty of downforce too.
And you got plenty of downforce. For the pro stocks, they don't have the downforce. They need some more traction, more glued down track to help them since they don't want to put any wing on the cars, which I don't really understand why they don't, because they're making 1400 horsepower now. Put some wing on the car, boys.
Well, we definitely have more spray on the track for Jonathan's brother Shane, who comes to the starting line clinched into the countdown already against V Gaines, who started strong, kind of fell apart there in the middle, but here over the last couple of races that Kendall car's been running better.
Yeah, they brought that new Dodge Dart, and they definitely struggled with it with a four-link problem that was actually rubbing, and they didn't catch it right away. And then when they made that change, they still struggled trying to get the setup. But as you mentioned, Dave, they've really started to improve. Shane Gray in the other lane, though, that car has really been running well performance-wise all year long. When I do my power rankings on that performance formula, he's pretty much always in the top five and more often than not in the top three. Car makes a lot of power.
Surprisingly, no round wins the last 3 years here for Shane Gray. Meanwhile, V on the other side was the runner-up last year to Mike Edwards. The only time in 17 prior races at Brainerd, V Gaines has been passed the second round.
Well, V's already gone into pre-staged. Pre-stages. Now they're both going to go in and light the second bulb and mat the throttle and try to hit the tree.
Keep it in the groove. Shane gets away first. And with a 661, gets to the finish line first as well. So Johnny's got one son pushed through to the second round.
Back in the pit of Robert Height for our Napa track fact as this team gets the car turned around to go back up to the start line after doing that burnout. They did put fresh oil in, a whole new clutch pack, refueled the car, and that's about it before they're going to roll up to the start line again. But Robert, for you, you just told me you've been in and out of this car four times already. You haven't even made a pass. What does that do to you mentally?
Oh, it wears you out. I mean, it's just you have to get up when you get in one of these cars. And now when all this happens, you got to relax and get down. down. Now I've got to get back up and get out there. Bob Task is tough, and I've got to do my job. So my guys, they're working hard in here. Even saw them checking the blower. You know, we've never go up there and just do a burnout and stop it. So my guys check everything. They want to see how the blower feels after just a burnout.
Very interesting. Thank you, Robert.
Dave Conley, is he on his way to Top Fuel next year for Bob Vandergrift Racing? That's the rumor. He's got himself a big-time reaction time advantage over Chris McGahey, driving the car that did win here last year.
778. Low ETA to me. 660 with a 4, 207 miles per hour. I saw Chris McGahey. Looked like he blew the engine up big time on his run.
10 years ago here, Dave Conley won his first pro stock race over Greg Anderson.
We're going to take another look. Watch the right side of your screen. Just past half track, you're going to see some smoke come out of Chris McGahey's car. And then shortly after that, whatever broke big time. Ooh. A lot of smoke, and there'll be some pretty good damage to that engine, I believe.
Very costly moment there for Chris McGahey, as those engines in these cars are not cheap. On board, riding with Jed Coughlin. Already countdown clinched with a couple of wins this year in Atlanta and Englishtown. Take on Larry Morgan. 25th time these two have faced off head-to-head. Jeggy's won 19 of them previously. He's got himself a big-time advantage on the reaction time.
660 with a 2:208.42. Nice job, guys.
That now represents slow elapsed
actually,
time.
The car felt really nice until about the last 200-300 feet. So, good job.
You heard Jeg talking on the radio about this. I'm a little bit surprised. I mean, we've seen the best runs of the weekend thus far, but not by a whole lot. I thought they'd be running a little bit quicker than they are with these conditions.
Greg Anderson is a power rank driver, and Greg Anderson is now free and clear to add to his points total. Chris McGahey, the driver in eighth, V gains ahead of him. Behind, Larry Morgan, Roger Brogdon, everybody, and is out of this race. So, Greg, it's now become very easy for him.
I mean, if you just go to the final round, he'll move up another position. But first, he's got to get around Derek Kramer.
And what did Derek Kramer do this weekend, stat guy?
He went on Craigslist and bought a vehicle to drive around the zoo. They took the roof off. They took the doors off. They put some lights on. And he and his dad had a great time. They're going to actually sell it again on Monday and get some of their bucks back.
Somebody back there in the zoo will probably buy it, too.
Guaranteed.
Absolutely. Derek Kramer looking for his first round win. And if you're anybody in this countdown chase trying to battle for that top spot, Chris McGahey ahead of Greg, maybe Jonathan Gray behind him, now would be a great time, these drivers would think, to see Derek Kramer get his first round win.
Oh, he's got a big advantage.
Double 0-4. Did he just steal one?
Oh!
Yes, he did it! Yeah. Derek Kramer has just earned his first round win.
Wow.
Look at the ET on Greg Anderson's side.
Low ET by a bunch, a 657 at 209 miles per hour, and he's going home.
No need to sell that van just yet.
Jeez. A double 04 reaction time for Derek Kramer, over 700th of a second advantage over Greg Anderson off of the starting line, and obviously he needed pretty much every bit of it. As you take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam by Justin Nose, Derek Kramer advances in a huge upset.
No disrespect to Derek Kramer, Greg Anderson will be upset with himself. Look at the starting line. They can't believe it, especially when you try digesting those numbers. How does a 664 beat a 657? 004 on the reaction timer. On a single, here is Alan Johnson. Shouldn't automatically give it to him based on what we just saw. Certainly the lane choice is something he's thinking about, but to beat that, he's got to beat a 772, and he crushed it, 660 with a one. So Alan Johnson will have lane choice against Vincent Nobile in round two.
Greg Anderson, the question becomes, how big of an opportunity was just missed right there?
Humongous, Gary. That's pitiful. I don't know how I pulled that one off, but obviously I screwed up. So I apologize to all the Summit guys. Obviously I had a fantastic hot rod as low ET by about 300 so far. So that one's all on me. All I can do is pick my nose up off the ground and go on to Indy. Another one of my favorite racetracks and try and win that one. But doggone it, I love Brainerd. I got a lot of history here, and I sure didn't make a very good statement to all my family and friends here. That's a bummer, but we'll go on. I'll pick my head up and I'll go on.
Thanks, Greg.
Well, let's talk about the way that's set up. Derek Kramer's best run was a 675, so I'm sure Greg went up there and said, okay, let's play it safe. Let's hit an 040 and 050. He was off. Hit an 070. Wasn't the light he was looking for. Derek Kramer goes out, makes a perfect run, runs his best ET by a tenth, and gets the win.
Well, here comes Greg's teammate, Jason Line. Countdown clinched already, up against Mark Hogan. There's Jason, Dad Lawrence, Mom Maxine, brothers Ben and Lance, a whole lot of aunts, uncles, cousins, dogs, nephews, the whole Line community here in support of Jason. And he does proud for them. 6:57.3. No upset here. Jason Line advances.
Derek Kramer, you pull a stunning upset. Anytime you meet a guy like Greg Anderson who's involved in a countdown battle, that's got to be special satisfaction. So which is better, the 004 reaction time or just the overall win?
Oh, at this point, I'll take the win. I know I've been struggling driving the last couple of weeks, but, you know, 004, you can't complain too much about that. There's not a lot of room improvement there, so I'll take the win any way I can get it.
Now, they were showing video, and I didn't get a chance to see it here earlier, of your special zoo car for the weekend. How did that all come about?
Well, my clutch guy, Dwayne, worked for V prior to working for us, and he's kind of had this idea floating around in his head for the past 12 years, and finally this year we kind of made it happen.
And how has the reaction been?
Everyone has really loved it. Everyone thought, you know, that was pretty fun. It was neat, and it was a good time.
Having a great time at Brainerd. Thanks.
Thank you.
Well, the new low standard was just set by Jason Line, 6:57.3. But you know Erica Ender-Stevens will challenge that. And Dave River out of Maquoketa, Iowa, will keep Erica and her elite team honest here.
Well, that's the key for Erica. Just go down the racetrack, not get too much tire shaking, and hit those gears just right. We know she has the power. But Jason Line and Greg Anderson have been running very well coming into this event, too. Oh, something happens.
Dave Rivers gets his first ever round win on numbers I'm still trying to analyze. Dave goes 0-12 on the reaction timer. Take a look at Erica Ender-Stevens. That's triple zeros and lost.
Wow.
A big surprise here. Erica Ender-Stevens is trying to lock up the number one seed. Has just now opened the door big time for her buddy, Alan Johnson. And Jason Line. Wow, it was an eventful first session of Pro Stock, the first session of Funny Car. We'll finish when we come back as Robert Height and Bob Tasca complete round one. The first order of business at Brainerd International Raceway and the Lucas Oil Nationals, the NHRA Meliello Drag Racing Series, finally complete round one of Funny Car. Bob Tasca and Robert Height, after being shut off and returning to the pits, Height's in trouble. Bob Tasca wants wind lights.
Wow.
He just got one. 4:15.4 beats a quicker, but losing 4:13. Robert Height had to pedal it. That gave him enough advantage for Tasca to drive by.
How about that? I mean, Bob Tasca had the ragtime advantage. You saw the back pedal by Robert Height. Was just not able to catch him as Bob Tasca advances to the second round.
Boy, we have seen some crazy things happening here on a gray day in Brainerd. Look at Bob Tasca's reaction. Like I said, Bob told me this weekend, wind lights. Wind lights cures everything. It's been a tough, tough year. You can hear Bob screaming underneath that helmet. So here now is officially the second round ladder for Funny Car as John Force, Del Worsham, Bob Tasca races Tommy Johnson Jr. on the top side. On the bottom, it's Caps and DeJoria picking their lanes against their Don Schumacher Racing teammates.
Well, let's take one more look at the run. You're going to see the advantage for Tasca and then the back pedal for Robert Height at that point. Tasca's making a pretty good run. Then it starts to lay over a little bit on the other end. Robert Height was reeling in, but couldn't quite make it. But let's take a look at our Geico traction area.
Okay.
It's pan pressure. It's when a piston is damaged and allows the cylinder pressure to bypass the piston rings, creating pressure in the oil pan. And that smoke you saw out of Tasca's car, that's normally what happens when that piston is damaged. They let off the throttle. All that oil comes up out of the oil pan and out the headers, usually an indication of some hurt pistons.
Well, Mother Nature's thrown some curveballs at us today, but the NHRA knows how to hit those out of the park. Top Fuel is back for round number two already. The drivers with lane choice against their opponents include Antron Brown, Steve Torrance, Doug Coletta, and Sean Langdon. We kick it off with Antron Brown versus Larry Dixon.
Antron's first ever top fuel win came against LD. Another big time boomer. This time it's Dixon in the right lane. A concussion felt all around BIR.
Well, we're seeing a lot of this, and it's a situation. I mean, the conditions are good. Sometimes you just don't get enough fuel in it, or you get a cylinder dropped out, and then a cylinder head pushed, or a gasket pushed out on Larry Dixon's car, and then eventually gets all mixed up and says, I'm not liking this too much, and we're going to just let her go. That's what happens to Larry. A little backfire out of Andron, too.
These teams have figured out how to really get these engines locked down tight so that when they do let go, look at that. Antron's even laying over a little bit.
So I think something might have broke on Antron because you see the chassis go down and then cylinders were going out and the chassis starts to unbow and then kaboom. Antron's still in 377 with all that going on.
Eric Anders Stevens enjoys a perfect light, but that's where the enjoyment ended. And I know this isn't the way you wanted to come back. How perplexing is this situation?
Big time. I've been waiting to talk to you. I've been thinking about it. And for starters, 000 sucks. I don't want to be anywhere that close to it. It's pretty tight here. Everybody's been good on the tree. I slowed my pedal up a bunch this morning. I threw an extra 100th in it, and we were still that close to red. So the starting line is awesome. I don't know what happened. I let the clutch out. It felt clean. It felt nice. It went through low really, really well. I pulled second gear. It shook. It didn't take second. So I threw it in third and didn't take third. And at that point, I went to abort and looked over, and he was ahead of me. So I just, that was it. So, it's really unfortunate for this Elite Motorsports team. It's certainly not what we had in mind for our comeback. But the good news is Dave River got his first round win, and it's with Elite Performance under the hood. So we'll be up here cheering for him next round, and we'll head back to Oklahoma and get ready for the big go.
Thank you. AJ within 7, Jason Line now within 11. Tony Schumacher, Sean Langan, no buildup needed. Sarge 376.3, wow. 326 miles an hour. Margin of victory about 0.03 of a second.
Two good drivers on the starting line. Tony Schumacher had gave up about 0.03 of a second to Sean Langdon. We call that pretty much about as close to dead even in a fuel car. Although as close as the top fuel cars have been running lately, you don't even want to give up that much. But it didn't hurt because, as you said, 0.03 of a second quicker. Schumacher ran, and that was the difference to move him into the semifinal round.
Dave River, you get your first professional round victory in pro stock. Tell us what it feels like.
It's bittersweet, guys. It feels great, but Erica and Richard and all the teams helped us tremendously. We got their power under the hood. It's bittersweet, but it feels great for us. My team works so hard. It's been a long time coming, but God kept us both safe, and that's the main thing.
Well, congratulations. Enjoy this.
Thank you, Gary. We appreciate it.
And get ready for the second round.
Thank you.
Morgan Lucas, Steve Torrence. Torrence up in smoke. And Morgan, 379.4. Is he on his way to another trophy given to him by his mother?
Wouldn't bet against it.
Three races, three semis this year for Morgan Lucas. One more pair of top fuel, Doug Coletta, Spencer Massey to come as Bob Tasca has his Ford back in the pits to begin the turnaround.
Right,
he races Tommy Johnson Jr. We are in hustle mode today at the Lucas Oil Nationals Brainerd International Raceway. The NHRA Meliello Drag Racing Series today at the Lucas Oil Nationals, race 17 of 24, and it has been trying, but it has been good. We've seen upsets. We've seen drivers getting their first round wins ever, and right now we have the top fuel point leader, number one in Mike Dunn's power rankings, Doug Coletta, taking on the defending event champion in Spencer Massey. Oh, and a great race, 372.
Look at that number.
Holy cow.
And look at that losing number. Jeez, a 375, and he had the advantage off the starting line, and he still get beat?
Jim Oberhoffer just threw down. This fits easily in the top 10 ever. The sixth quickest run in Top Fuel history.
Spencer Massey had over 200ths of a second advantage off of the starting line, then runs a 3.75. I would have bet any amount of money that he would have won the race with that happening. But don't forget, you got Doug Collette and Jim Oberhoff from the other lane, and they laid down a pass, a 3.72 elapsed time, and they pretty much needed almost all of it to get the win. Nice job.
That eighth mile ET, 2.984 seconds. That car was flying. The Lucas Oil photo finish on this one, the margin of victory, just a little bit more than a hundredth of a second. Call it about 4 feet for the driver that just went 3.72.2. Jimmo, pump your fist. You earned that one. So the semifinal matchups feature winners here at Brainerd International Raceway. All of them. It's Antron Brown will race Morgan Lucas. Lane Choice to Ant on the other side. DK and Big Red Mac Tools pick their lane with a 400ths of a second advantage over Tony Schumacher.
Well, Doug Coletta just got advised of the numbers, and how do they digest?
I tell you, Jimmo and this Mac Tools team, what an effort, what a run. You know, the conditions are really good out here, and obviously we're down to trying to make it happen with these last few cars in this race here. So just hats off to these guys, and you know, Connie and everybody, we're just trying to make it happen.
And you had to have a 72 because he ran a 75 next to you.
Incredible.
Thanks.
Well, the point leader did his job. Antron Brown, second in points, is staying pace on the other side of the ladder. So we continue racing today at the Lucas Oil Nationals.
Chase Elliott. Tearing up the track in the Napa 9 car. It's hard to believe you're only 18.
You guys even remember what it was like when you were 18?
Nah.
Really?
No, not at all.
I do. I was awesome.
Whether you're a rookie, veteran, or a legend, conquer the job with Napa know-how.
Sorry, guys. I never would have thought making duck calls would have stirred up this much excitement.
No kidding. We got him coming up here.
Shortcut time!
Yeah! That's what I'm talking about! Ah. You sure this is a good idea?
Oh, yeah. I got this.
I can't guarantee you how this will end, but Peak can guarantee your radiator for life. Introducing the Peak Run True Guarantee. Check it out at peakguarantee.com.
Something happens when you give your hair air. You get a natural look without the gray. Only Just for Men has Air Active, the only technology that uses oxygen in the air to get rid of gray while leaving the natural variations in your hair. No ammonia, no peroxide, no overcoloring. Just air. Just you and the look you want. Just for Men.
Stop death. Diablo 3 Ultimate Evil Edition, rated mature.
There's a reason no one says easy like Monday morning. Sundays are the warrior's day to unplug and recharge. What if this feeling could last all week? With CenturyLink as your trusted partner, it can. Our visionary cloud infrastructure and global broadband network free you to focus on what matters. With custom communication solutions and dedicated support, your business can shine all week long. CenturyLink, your link to what's next.
Friday night, buddy, you are gonna need a wingman. And my cash back keeps the party going.
But my airline miles take it worldwide.
It shouldn't be this hard. With creditcards.com, it's easy to search hundreds of cards and apply online. Creditcards.com.
Great day to be at the Little League World Series. These kids have been watching this their whole life.
Celebrating 75 years of Little League, the Little League World Series continues through August 24th on the networks of ESPN. Presented by Kellogg's Frosted Flakes.
It has been a trying day in the NHRA Meliello Drag Racing Series today at the Lucas Oil Nationals as NHRA's Safety Safari nearly has the track ready to go again after another brief shower. Meanwhile, back in the pits, Bob Tasca is celebrating a big round one win over Robert Height. John Kernan has more.
Yeah, that was a big win over Robert Height in the first round, but Bob, something kind of weird happened to the car. Describe what went on.
I had a little shake going by the 60-foot mark, and then I felt the motor nose over. We put a piston in the pan, and when you do that, it creates an unbelievable vibration in the engine, and I couldn't see. I mean, it was completely blurred out in front of me. I couldn't see him, couldn't hear him, and then I just saw the glow of the wind light come on. So that was a big win for us. Obviously, that AAA team is, you know, top of the page for a reason. But this Motorcraft Quick Lane car, we got a lot of fight in us. Just might be our day.
What about the countdown to the championship and being a spoiler? How are you going to like that role, and you going to make a lot of people pay?
We're going to have to start off this weekend being a spoiler. Yes.
Just the seventh round win of the season for Bob Tasca. Definitely been a struggle for him. Well, Monday night ESPN brings you Monday Night Football preseason coverage. The Redskins, Robert Griffin III looks to bounce back as Johnny Manziel and the Browns look for a win on the road. One of the most highly anticipated preseason game, the Cleveland Browns versus the Washington Redskins, Monday at 8 on ESPN. Well, Bob Tasca's car is rolling toward the staging lanes, which means the second round is right around the corner. Bob Tasca set to take on Tommy Johnson Jr., TJ with the lane choice. Meanwhile, Gary Gerald has caught up with Top Fuel's most successful racer.
Yes, indeed. And that, of course, is Tony Schumacher. Multiple championships, couple of wins already this year, fourth in championship points, getting ready to head to the lanes. A long, long day for everybody. Is it at all difficult to maintain a focus, Tony?
Well, not to maintain a focus, to maintain the energy, I think, you know, to get up for a race. I mean, we got to run Coletta. They ran a 72, an outstanding performance by that car, and that team's been doing it all year long. You got to get up for that, and you get up and it rains, and you got to relax. You know, your heart, you can only stay pumped up for so long, but I got to full throttle, man. We're good. I'm safe, man. It always helps me just a little bit. It seems to be the energy that I need. Sometimes I'm too calm. I found that over the years I'm really good at staying calm, but sometimes I need a little pep. I just need a little bit.
Is that 72 that you alluded to that Duck threw down, is that intimidating?
Well, it's not intimidating. It's just, it's a fact. I mean, we're going to have to run fast, and I'm going to have to leave on them if you want to win. I think it's respect. They did a great job. That was a fantastic run, and they're worthy of winning this race. We got to stop them.
Thanks.
Got it.
Both of Tony Schumacher's wins this season have come against Doug Coletta. Well, after the Brainerd event, we head to the U.S. Nationals and look forward to the Traxxas Nitro Shootouts. We're on Saturday, Top Fuel. And the winners here will take center stage. The eighth vote is a vote, rather, the eighth driver, and that's where you have the opportunity to head to NHRA's Facebook page already. Now until Tuesday, August the 26th at noon, you can vote. That driver then what happened? Gets a percentage?
Gets a percentage of the votes. If he gets 35% of the vote, he gets 35
ping pong balls
that'll come up, gives him a better chance at getting that eighth and final position. But you take a look at the numbers of drivers that are already in there. Some great names in there, including Tony Schumacher. You got to like his chances based on what he does in Indy anyway. And Doug Coletta and Antoine Brown obviously been running very strong.
Drivers eligible to be voted for: Bob Vandergriff, Brittany Force, who won last year's vote, Clay Milliken, J.R. Todd, Steve Torrence, Terry McMillan, just to name a few. Let's check in now with Jamie Howe.
Well, Tommy Johnson Jr. started off the weekend fifth in the point standings, but by winning the first round and Courtney Force losing the first round, he has now moved past her and is in fourth. But, Tommy, you have bigger goals. What are those?
Well, I want to catch Rom. You know, going into the countdown, it doesn't really matter, but you want to be as high as you can. And then third's obtainable, so see if we can't sneak that away from Caps and get up there in third. But right now I'm happy with fourth.
It's been a long day. It's been a weird day. A lot of in the car, out of the car. As you get ready now for your second round matchup, where is your mindset?
Yeah, I've had to flush my brain a few times today. You know, you get all pumped up and ready to go, and then you get out, and it's like, okay, get ready again. And then you get back in, you get out again. And just trying to be on and be up at the right time. That's been the biggest thing today, just trying to manage your thoughts and be ready when it's time.
With the conditions as tricky and as changing as they have been, having lane choice, what kind of deal does that make?
I don't know if it's too big a deal. I mean, we've seen good runs in both, but, you know, it's always nice to have that advantage. And if there's, especially with the weather the way it is, it's nice to have that choice last minute if you need it.
It'll be Bob Tasca he faces.
Well, I'm Tommy Johnson Jr., one of the drivers already qualified for the Traxxas Nitro Shootout in Funny Car. Meanwhile, other teams like Tim Wilkerson's Levi Ray and Shop Crew, they're looking for the vote. That's Travis Hollywood Worth campaigning for his driver.
Gotta love that, but take a look at all the other drivers in there. And one name not on there, also Fast Jack Beckman, your defending Traxxas champion, who leveled it in getting the win last year. He's gonna have to get voted in.
Again, he got that vote. Actually, he got in on points last year, but you can see the seven drivers that are already in. Names that aren't: Bob Tasca, Dell Worsham, Jack Beckman, Matt Hagen, Tim Wilkerson, Tony Pedregon.
Wow. Some
great names out there. Well, Ron Capps is getting set to put the safety equipment on and get ready to strap into the race car. Second round of Funny Car, then the semifinals of Top Fuel when we come back to the Lucas Oil Nationals. Been a long but patient day. It's time for a blast from the past here at Brainerd International Raceway. Some of the iconic moments, like in 1997 when Mike Dunn wheel stood that car. Holy cow, I just saved it.
I thought it was going over. I was grabbing a whole lot of brake thinking it wasn't going to get saved, but it came back down.
Gary Selzy and John Smith, one of the scariest moments we saw here. Gary crossing over into the path of John Smith, who would go through some surgery there, the engine getting into the driver's compartment there.
In 2004, the late Eric Medlin getting his first win with his dad John looking on, gets the bath, and then the perfect slide and sticks the landing.
First of back-to-back wins here at Brainerd International Raceway for the late Eric Medlin, who we miss every day. Well, the track is almost ready. Boy, the NHRA Mellow Yellow Safety Safari guys have been earning their money today at the Lucas Oil Nationals, where the rumor mill, well, it's a swirling over the future of Pro Stock's Dave Conley. Gary Gerald caught up with him after his round one win against Chris McGahey.
Dave Conley lays down a 660 lap, which is low of the weekend. But what's it like when you've waited all day before you finally can get behind the wheel?
It's Mother Nature, and we've had a couple beautiful days here during qualifying, and it usually don't happen to us here in Brainerd, but it did. And Track Safari is doing a great job getting us a good track, and looked like it might have been a little iffy there, the first pair with Jonathan and Vincent, but I went right down the track, and it seemed to be fine. I don't know what happened to Chris. He said he might have blown up, but got some folks from Charter Communications here this weekend, so hopefully and get it in, and we'll just keep plugging away and doing our best.
And of course, we have to ask you about your future, because we keep hearing all this talk, including some strong words from Bob Vandergriff about you possibly taking a seat of a Top Fuel dragster next season.
You use that word very well, possibly, and there's a very good possibility of that, but time will tell, and we'll see. And if it does happen, that's going to be one crazy animal to get behind the wheel of, and I can't wait.
Thank you.
Doug Coletta's guys are busy getting his car ready for a semifinal matchup against Tony Schumacher. Just going through routine maintenance right now. I'm standing here in the pit with his crew chief, Jim Oberhofer, who just tuned that car to that 372. And how'd you do that, and what do you got up your sleeve for the semifinals?
I don't know. I guess we got pretty lucky that round with the Mack Tools car. But, this racetrack's awfully good, and we know this car is quick and fast. And when you're running any of those DSR cars, that's a tough bunch over there, and their stuff's really starting to run really well, and we knew we needed to run well. And, we said, hell with it. We're going to go up there, we're going to hang it all out there, and we're going to try to run this thing as quick and fast as we can, and we're very pleased with that 72. And we're going to have to run, we got to run the Sarge next round. He's been a thorn in our side for a number of years, so hopefully we can keep that up and maybe do something about the same.
They'll let it eat in the semifinals.
Well, after we leave Brainerd, the last race before the countdown begins is NHRA's biggest. It's the Chevrolet Performance U.S. Nationals, with qualifying Sunday, August the 31st at 11 a.m. and 5 p.m. The finals Monday, September the 1st at noon. Both events are on ESPN2, and live Monday finals also available on ESPN3 at 11 a.m. in the East. You want to see legends? You got to come to the big go. Right, Jamie?
As we look ahead to the next event, the 60th anniversary of the U.S. Nationals, the NHRA has put together the top six moments so far in the history of Indy, and these are the six of them. And throughout the weekend, fans who show up will be able to relive these moments with the drivers who actually were competing in them. You see on one of these cards here, Tony Schumacher on Indy's winningest drivers. When the fans show up, the first 300 would actually get to take home one of these commemorative credentials, and on the back, they can even get a couple of autographs. Pretty cool if you can make it out to the race.
Schumacher not the only one. Bob Glidden, Don Garlitz, Don Perdomo, Tom McEwen, Kenny Bernstein, Shirley Muldowney. The list goes on and on and on, Mike. It's going
to
be great.
I can't wait to get to Indy.
Well, second round of Funny Car on a trying day here in Brainerd has burned out with the first pair, Ron Capps and Jack Beckman. Stat guy, you got more on Fast Jack?
Yeah, big round for Jack Beckman trying to get that top 10 position. And so far this season, this is the 13th time he is racing a teammate head-to-head. But here's the stat. He's even right now. 6 wins, 6 losses.
Here is the ladder presented by Lucas Oil that shows you the first pair, with pairs including Del Worsham, Tommy Johnson Jr., and Alexis DeJoria picking their lanes against their opponent upcoming. Countdown, critical situation for Jack Beckman. With Tim Wilkerson already being out, they could change the position right here.
With the win for Jack Beckman, but he's got to get around his teammate Ron Capps, who has lane choice. Everybody's taking the left lane, but I can tell you right now, there's no difference. We saw great numbers out of both lanes. Sometimes what tends to make crew chiefs take one lane over the other, the tuning window might be a little bit wider, slightly wider than that left-hand lane. So in other words, if you're off just a little bit, it still goes down the track. But if they both hook up, you can run good numbers in either one.
Oh, given to Ron Capps.
Wow,
margin of victory, 0.03 of a second. The Don stunned perhaps at the outcome of that, but Ron Tobler and Napa know how to get it done. And for Ron Capps, 11 straight round wins now in Brainerd.
Man, how about that drag race? Whole shot advantage by 0.06 of a second for Ron Capps, and obviously to win on a whole shot, he needed 0.06. Neither driver had great reaction times, an 0.090 to an 0.096. Ron Capps, though, they both made great runs on the racetrack. Margin of victory, 0.03 of a second at the stripe. What a race.
Lucas Oil photo finish cam shows you, thank goodness we have electronics. The photo finish cams, the margin of victory by Capps, very, very narrow. What a way to start the second round of Funny Car. You know there's going to be a big smile on the face of Ron Capps when that helmet comes off. Capps now waiting to see who he races. Will it be Hagen or DeJoria? Next pair on the racetrack, Tommy Johnson Jr. and Bob Tasca. Gary Gerald.
You've been racing a long time, Ron Capps, and every time you see one like that, as tight as it is, 0.03 of a second, the margin of victory, what goes through your mind when you digest those numbers?
I don't even know. You don't know. You're shoved back in the back seat. People at home, you don't understand. Where here it says Napa Auto Care Center, that is where my head is. It ain't up here by the side window like a normal car. So when we don't know who won, we get down and we look shocked. We don't know. You can kind of hear them like a video game, sort of out the window. And this is all going on at 320 miles an hour, but you just don't know sometimes. And then you pray that that little tiny wind light on the guardrail, about 2 football fields past the guardrail, lights up in your lane. Other than that, you have no idea what's going on. It's the most unbelievably difficult thing to drive, but the most unbelievably fun thing to drive. So, oh my God, we'll take it, man.
You bet you will. See you in the semis.
And that battle for 10th rages on with just 4 rounds of racing at the U.S. Nationals to decide who will be 10, the top 10. Beckman trails by 16 heading to Indy. Now it's TJ and Bob Tasca. Again, it's all about wind lights for the quick lane driver. Not going to happen in round two. Tommy Johnson Jr. goes 4-12 with a one. Tommy Johnson Jr., we talked about the history here, racing Dick LeHaye in 1990, runner-up here in 93 in Top Fuel, racing Eddie Hill.
Jack Beckman here. It's hard to put into words. We were just talking with Ron Capps. When a race is that tight, 404s for each of you, and so much at stake, how do you digest it?
It's tough to recover that much from all the things that have been thrown at us, to improve that much in the period of a weekend and still not be able to turn on the wind line. You know, you're going up against Ron Tobler and 700 runs of data, and we're dealing with 4 runs of data. I'm very proud of our crew for being able to get the Valvoline car that quick, but at the end of the day, it's wind lights that matter. Now the silver lining is we closed up 1 round more on Wilkie. I just don't want to be in this position. We'll go test for 2 days. I think we can figure out some more stuff. We give Okahar and Cunningham and Terry another few runs on this car and get them Labor Day. But with Nitro, it's a tough pill.
Some drama to be played out, seriously, at Indy.
72nd meeting coming up between Del Worsham and John Force. Number one in the peak power rankings, according to Mike Dunn. That is what's coming up when we come back to Brainerd, Minnesota, where earlier today, drivers begin putting their names on the countdown board. That's how everybody figures out here if you're a countdown clinch driver. And watch Alan Johnson having a little fun early this morning, maybe thinking about switching that to number one. Guess what? He could possibly take that away, as Erica Ender Stevens was eliminated earlier today here in Brainerd, Minnesota. Back in a moment for the Lucas Oil NHRA Nationals, where that man, John Force, will race Del Worship. Napa Know-How crew getting set to go back to work here at the Lucas Oil Nationals. The NHRA Meliello Drag Racing Series will descend upon that car and try to turn it around quick time on a troublesome day with Mother Nature here in Brainerd, Minnesota. John Force, Del Worship. This weekend is one more step closer to winning. In fact, the last number one qualifier to win this race, you got to go back to 2005 when the late Eric Medlin did it for John Force Racing. Track record speed, by the way, 320 miles an hour.
Well, John Force got the advantage off the start line by quite a bit, 043 light, but he deep staged it to get that number. In other words, that run would have been even quicker if he would have stayed shallow, probably knocked about 400s off of that time, but 320 miles per hour at the stripe, 271 at the eighth mile. That was probably actually about a 402 run if John, like I said, would have just touched it right in when that stage light came on.
And Jimmy Prock is strutting.
Oh,
you
yeah.
See that?
He's been doing that for a while.
Yes, he has. So you know John Force will be fired up when he pops out of the Castrol GTX high mileage car here in just a moment. We know that John Force will race Tommy Johnson Jr. in the semifinals today. Force going in search of win number 12 here in Brainerd, Minnesota. So the current standings, we could have a change at number one in funny car as John Force is closed within two of Robert Height.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing because Robert had a pretty good lead there a few races ago.
Yes, he did. It's that guy.
You know, it's interesting. Robert Height and Erica Ender Stevens both took over the points lead after the Vegas race. They have led for 13 events. They're both in jeopardy of losing that points lead here this weekend.
Yes, they are. Well, as John Force makes his way around the top end, we know the next pair will be Matt Hagen versus Alexis DeJoria. DeJoria already with two wins, looking for a third. No female funny car driver has won three races in a single season. She'd love to be the first to do that.
Talking with Alexis DeJoria's crew chief, Tommy DeLago, he said he was very satisfied with the way the car left the starting line in that last round, so they've made no changes there. However, he did tell me there's a lot more left out there down the racetrack. So he has tuned it up, trying to break into the threes on this run.
Big deal, too, for Alexis DeJoria, who today eclipses the 100th round of racing. This is her 101st now.
Well, the focus right now has got to be the Christmas tree because she has been struggling the last two races. As I mentioned, you go back to Seattle, she got beat on a hole shot by John with that 150 light we heard in her interview. She almost two-stepped it against Courtney when she started to go squeeze down on it, then backed off, the light came on, and she was late. Now, just get the focus on there and try to basically see when that amber light gets on and hit it as quick as you can because that man right there, Matt Hagen, is one of the best in the business.
This is a rubber match meeting between the two, the seventh time. Dead even, 3-3. And Alexis, you know, she's got plenty of girl power back on the starting line supporting her. Hagen looking to go to his third consecutive semifinal. Be the first time in 2014 the driver of the Express Lane car has done that.
I do like Tommy DeLago's strategy, though. The middle of the racetrack will hold quite a bit, and we saw John will go 271 miles per hour in the middle of the racetrack. If he can get it, car accelerating very quickly the first couple hundred feet. He throws everything at it. As long as it hasn't worn too much clutch, it'll run a number.
Hagen racing his old crew chief, Alexis, with the track record here set earlier at a 401. Second off the line, first across the stripe. Say hello to the sub 4 second pass. 3.998.
Tommy D. Yeah. I tell you what, I love it when a plan comes together. When the crew chief can start calling his shots, that is a beautiful thing. At 399 at 315 miles per hour, she was running 274 miles per hour at the eighth mile. That's what Tommy D was talking about. Like the way it left just as hard as the first round, but then he started throwing everything at it. Boy, that thing really marched through the middle of the racetrack because Matt Hagen had the advantage off the starting line, but boy, look at that car. Just all the mail all the way to the finish line. Great job.
The 29th. Sub 4 second pass, the second by Alexis DeJoria. That car is thundering today.
And with Tommy DeLago, you told me you were going for the threes there. So what's it feel like to run a number you say you're going to run?
Well, it feels really good. And like I said, we've been testing all weekend, so we get one more test run. We'll have some fun.
They're testing, and they're also trying to win a Wally. And who knows, maybe set some more track records in the meantime.
Well, there's one very happy driver underneath that helmet who has been bouncing since you popped out of that car. Look at that, 3.998. You know who took notice of that? No doubt John Force and Tommy Johnson Jr., one half of the Funny Car semifinals. John's 406 gets lane choice. On the other side, Alexis is 3.998, good enough for lane choice. The 14th sub 4 second run in 2014. Well, when we come back, it's semifinal time in Top Fuel as Antron Brown will take on Morgan Lucas. Morgan in the Lucas Oil car at the Lucas Oil Nationals. Life moves pretty quick on the NHRA Meliello Drag Racing Series at the Lucas Oil Nationals, Brainerd International Raceway. You see those storms just popping up here. Trying to threaten our NHRA Meliello Drag Racing Series event. But we will get the last lap.
That's right.
Absolutely. Semifinal. So Antron Brown in that first matchup with lane choice against the number 12 qualifier who just loves this place. And then it will be Doug Coletta and Tony Schumacher. Don't forget what Dougie did just one round ago. This is a rematch of the 2012 final.
Oh,
won by
that.
Lucas. And guess
look
what?
At that run.
Lucas has done it again. 3.72.9. The second best time slip we've seen this weekend.
Oh, man. Well, we knew Morgan Lucas could drive a race car. I don't care how long he sits out. He can step in and leg that thing down there as good as anybody out there.
Career best numbers for Morgan.
But how about that? Aaron Brooks and the rest of that team putting that thing together and giving and just keeps getting better and better every run. Antra had a slight advantage off of the starting line, a little over a hundredth of a second. But boy, Morgan definitely had the hot rod on the racetrack.
Just the fifth time in 23 races, Morgan Lucas has beaten Antron, and he did it with a solid, resounding run. Look at Dad's reaction. Yeah, my kid did it. Morgan will have an opportunity for that third Lucas Oil Nationals win.
Well, Forrest, I mean, how about your son out there coming back, and now he's going to the finals here at Brainerd?
I tell you what, I can't be any happier. You see that speed? I mean, it's almost a record, you know, and the time itself, perfect. I just want to get this race in tonight. I'm so happy for our boys and the crew, and, you know, we got a part-time crew, and then we got the other crew that's coming over helping us out, so the Geico team, it's perfect.
Yes, it was perfect.
Yeah, here's our own race and a finale like this. Couldn't you ask for anything better except the weather a little bit better. Yeah. It's great, great day. Thanks a lot for asking.
And the burnouts that you saw Forrest grabbing his ears were for Tony Schumacher, the U.S. Army car, against Doug Coletta. This could be something special. Meanwhile, at the top end, Alexis DeJoria thinking about running in the threes. Now, Tommy DeLago told our crew that you were going to run in the threes. Did you have any inkling?
Well, when we got back to the pits, he said, we're going to give it a little bit more. And we already ran a 4.01, so that means to me that he's going to go for the swing for the fences. So, and he definitely did. Man, you know, Matt Hagen's such a tough opponent. You know, he's excellent on the tree, and his team is doing really good, too. Obviously, big contender, but our team's really got our car this year, and I'm so, so excited for Patron and Mack Tools and Redline Oil and Toyota. I mean, they've done such a good job supporting us, and now we're finally being able to give it back. So
big time delivery. Well
done. Thank you.
And a big time move up into points, too, as Alexis has passed Courtney in the standings. Well, what will we see here? We already know that we've had a 372.2 run out of that big red machine.
Still telling.
Better cinch up those belts. Hold on tight. This one could be stellar. answer it. 75 beats a 74.
Man.
Dougie with a whole shot win. Margin of victory, 53 10 thousandths. That stings the Don.
How about that? Doug Clutter with the whole shot advantage over the Sarge. And what, I'll tell you what, we're seeing some great runs. One thing about the weather, you hate to see the weather. A lot of fans will want to leave because they think the rain's coming in.
Shame on them.
And this is what you miss every time it happens. When you have these kind of conditions, I want to tell you fans, if you come to a drag race, don't leave until they tell you it's over, because you're going to miss this. This was a great drag race.
The reaction from Jim Oberhofer, priceless. And on the photo finish cam at the top end of the race course, you can see what that margin of victory looks like. 53 10 thousandths, about a foot and a half. Give it to the driver of the red Mack Tools machine. Meanwhile, the jaw-dropping number came courtesy of Morgan Lucas.
And Morgan was saying as he came out, there was some drama associated with that run. Please share.
We were rushing up to the staging lanes. It was kind of one of those situations where you just have to make a decision whether you're going to go up and try it or not. And put a fresh motor in for that run. Started up, oil pressure's really low. We going through everything. I mean, we had both teams working on it, checking bearings, checking everything we can. We changed pumps. Still, the pressure was low. Hit the gas, and that good old Lucas Oil Products got us to the finish line. I don't think I'd had any pressure at all, but just one of those deals when God's looking down on you. I got to say hi to my wife, my baby boy. This is pretty exciting, man. Really excited right now and really proud of this team. And that's my best run of my life. So it's funny to do that on a part-time schedule. Thanks, Aaron.
Maybe a little more than pretty exciting.
Yeah.
Of course, his baby, Hunter, 8 months old. He is crawling already. The top fuel final. Wow, this one looks set up to be a great one. Stat guy.
And when Antron Brown, the number one qualifier, was taken out by Morgan Lucas, we set some history. We have now gone 22 races without the number one qualifier winning in top fuel. That's the longest streak in the history of the class. Who was the last winner from number one there, Dave?
The man that's getting in the golf cart on the right side. How about Morgan Lucas, the last guy to pull that trick last year in Charlotte?
Ron Capps packing his chutes now as he gets ready for a semifinal matchup against Alexis DeJoria. We've talked about the drivers who are out of their routines today with all of the delays, but it's not just the drivers, it's also their teams. And finally, his crew doing this turnaround in angst as they get ready. Talked to crew chief Ron Tobler. He said that run was exactly what they were shooting for. It was a 404 with a 9. He said that was all they could ask for. They're going to run the same block as they head into the semifinal. So this is a very basic turnaround. We will be back with Pro Stock second round from the Lucas Oil NHRA Nationals after this.
The NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series out of sorts a bit at the Lucas Oil Nationals. This intermittent rain off and on has gotten the program kind of turned a little bit around. As we're set now for the second round only of Pro Stock. It sets up with Alan Johnson, Jed Coughlin, Jason Lyne, Dave Conley picking their lanes against their respective drivers, two of which earned their first ever round wins in the opening stanza. One of those, Dave River, he'll be in the left lane up against Dave Conley.
Dave River, who upset Erica Enders in the first round when Erica couldn't get her car to shift into second or third gear. Dave Conley's hoping he doesn't have those kind of problems, and if he doesn't, he should get the win. He's definitely been running the numbers compared to Dave this weekend.
Performance motor under the hood of Dave River that's just given him his second round win.
That is amazing. And if we go back and look at it, I'm going to tell you what I think happened there. When Dave River went into stage, it looked like the bottom stage light blinked. And I both think both drivers threw off just a little bit. Watch on the right side of your screen. Dave Conley's already pre-stage. Dave River's going to go in and pre-stage. Now, when they sat there for a little bit, Dave will go in first, left side of your screen. And then when Dave Rivers, Dave Conley goes in first, I forgot there's two Dave. Now watch when Dave River goes in, that light will blink right there.
Oh.
It threw both those drivers off, but it threw Dave Conley off more than did Dave River. Now that doesn't mean why the car didn't go down the track, but that's why Dave definitely had a 220 reaction time.
Good eye, Mike Dunn. Look at Erica.
How about that?
She knows it's coming. She saw the reaction time. She saw the blink. She knew Dave left second. Dave Conley, that is. Dave River earns another round win.
with Doug Coletta. We're seeing eye-popping numbers here as this day advances. It's been such a long day. What do you think it's going to take to walk out of here with a Wally against Morgan Lucas?
Yeah, I tell you, the Lucases, they love this place, and when it cools off, it's been plenty tight and plenty fast. So, you know, we're Morgan just laid one down. So, Jim, you know, I know he's got something up his sleeve back there, and it'll be great, great fun. And, you know, we'll just go up there and see what we got, give it our best with this Mack Tools car.
All right, I think they want you to autograph a site that goes up there announcing your number one spot here as we move to the countdown.
Perfect. Thank you.
And I'm with Robert River, the son of David, who just moved on to the semifinals. How'd you guys pull this off, and what's it like to do this?
Oh, I'll tell you, it's amazing. And we pulled it off, so everyone behind me. We all did a wonderful job. We came out with a good game plan. We never wish bad luck, but we just needed real good luck today, so we're moving on.
Yes, they are, with some good luck.
And you know what? Doug Coletta, with a round win in the final, could put a stranglehold on that number one qualifying spot. Well, Derek Kramer just earned his first round win against Greg. Now he's got Chegg. Pretty even off the starting line. Now who's got the better setup this time? It is Chegg Coughlin.
661-2, 207-88. Nice job. Just a little bit more of the same. A little lazy wandering around the first couple of games.
Jay talk a little lazy, a little bit wandering around. You saw him working the wheel through first and second gear. Then it sticks pretty good down on the other end. The 661's good enough to get the win.
Jay Coughlin, four times a winner here in Pro Stock, also has a 1997 Lucas Oil Sportsman win here. We get set now for the next pair, Alan Johnson, Vincent Nobile. But first, let's take a look back at Alexis DeJoria breaking into the 3-second barrier in Funny Car just a moment ago.
You may remember earlier in the season, Snap-on started the initiative to donate $10,000 to the Honor Flight Network for each sub 4-second funny car run. The total so far was at $10,000. But with that run by Alexis and Tommy DeLago, look at that. We're now up to $20,000.
Who wouldn't love to fill that Christmas tree out by the end of this year? It certainly could be done with some of the locations we go to. Reading, Pomona suddenly has become ripe for a 3-second racetrack.
I'll bet it'll be filled up by the end of the year, and it's a great cause, great organization. But right now you're on board with Alan Johnson, your number one qualifier, who got a bye in the first round and basically could experiment a little bit and try some things, but it's going to have to be focused right now because you've got to try to get around Vincent Nobile, who we saw in that matchup with Jonathan Gray get all kinds of sideways, had to push in the clutch, but Jonathan went across the center line, thus giving Vincent the win.
KB horsepower underneath the hood of Vincent Nobile. Jason Lyon visited with us on our E3 show Friday night. If you've never checked out that show, we encourage you. But Jason told the story about a motor that Vincent just leveled for that KB crew.
I think he said it was number 62, yeah. The first qualifying session here this weekend. Parts and pieces were coming out of it, but they put a fresh bullet in there and came out there, and they're going to try to get this win against Alan Johnson right now.
Check this out. Alan Johnson wins this round. He takes the point lead away from Erica Ender Stevens.
So Erica's probably rooting for Vincent.
I don't know. Good friends with Brutus. 003 for Vincent.
Wow.
But Alan not far off the mark, but guess what? AJ will not take over the point lead. Vincent Nobile goes 662. Think his dad's fired up?
Oh, man.
John's loving it for sure.
And take down the number one qualifier.
I'll tell you what, that kid could definitely let the clutch out on time. He was had an 0-11 rack time in the first round. 003, pushes it pretty much all the time, but he really pushes it against great competition, and that's what Alan Johnson is. And Alan and Vincent was able to just not only get the rack time advantage, but make the pass on the racetrack and get the win.
AJ lost the second round last year to the number one qualifier, Mike Edwards, as the number one qualifier, bows out in round two this year to Vincent Nobile. That's his dad, John. Driver of a Pro Stock machine, both in the NHRA and Mountain Motor Car, going through the gears with his son, reacting when the wind light comes on.
Well, you talk about uncharted waters. I think Dave River is swimming in them right now. How's it feel?
We certainly are. As a river, we're all wet. But we want to thank Richard, Nick, Jake, my family, the Lord, got us safe down there. The crew, everybody contributes. a volunteer crew. My son's crew chief. My daughter's here from Tucson. Feels great. We just thanks to everybody that helps us and supports us.
Hey, don't stop now. Keep it going.
Well, we're going to do our best next round. I don't know who we have or what we did, but, you know, we're in the semis, and it's just, it feels great.
Awesome. Thanks.
Thank you, Gary.
Well, this is Shane Gray. Shane will try to do what Vincent Nobile just did and take down a guy that can take over the point lead away from Erica Ender Stevens. Same story here for Jason Lyon, who was in a round of the driver of the Red Machine.
20 points per round. You see he's only 11 back, so I did the math. He would take over the point lead just like you said, David, right now.
It's good ciphering.
It is, isn't it? But right now, Jason Lyon has a very good race car, but Shane Gray, remember, that is a powerful race car over there in that left-hand lane.
Shane Gray has the reaction time advantage over Jason Lyon. But Jason Lyon has just taken over the Pro Stock points lead. Look at that run, 6.580 seconds. And now you're looking at number two in standings, walking away from the starting line.
Tell you what, Shane did his job, had 2.5 hundredths advantage off of the starting line, but Jason's car has just been so strong over the Western swing, so strong in qualifying here in Brainerd, and it just continues.
Well, the good news for Erica Enders Stevens, she can fall no lower than second. That's because Alan Johnson, who's now been dropped down to third, is out of competition today. But Jason, with a couple more round wins, could put a little gap on Erica Enders Stevens. And with one round of racing, one race, I should say, to go until the countdown starts, well, no female has ever been a number one seed in Pro Stock. That's what Erica had at stake. Look at the grin on Jason Lyon's face. Racing here in his native Minnesota with his father, his mother, his brother, his sisters, aunts, his uncles, nieces, cousins, nephews, everybody here cheering him on. He'd love to deliver in the semifinals. David River does not have lane choice. It's Jason Lyon with that solid 6.58. Well, this Saturday night, under the lights at the world's fastest half mile, NASCAR's best drivers bump, bang, and battle with Chase Hopes hanging in the balance. 43 drivers battle, 16 advance. Three races to go. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Bristol, presented by AutoZone, Saturday at 7 Eastern on ABC. Jeff Gordon back in control of the points. Well, when we come back, Funny Car semifinals are up next. Ron capped four wins here, including the last 2 years. Woo! Missed the scene in 2012 and again in 2013. Woo! For Ron capped, Brainerd, Minnesota is destination paradise.
The Lucas Oil NHRA Nationals is brought to you by Mellow Yellow. Go on yellow. Lucas Oil, the world leader of high-performance lubricants and problem-solving additives for everyday cars and trucks. And GEICO, saving people money on more than just car insurance.
Well, if you like explosions, then the Lucas Oil Nationals here at Brainerd International Raceway is for you. But on Monday night, ESPN brings you Monday night preseason football coverage. Robert Griffin III, Johnny Manziel, a classic matchup between the Browns and the Redskins. And for Johnny Manziel, Cleveland says they will announce the week one starter by Tuesday, but Monday night is Monday Night Football, 8 o'clock on ESPN. The NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series officials already determining that the conclusion of Pro Stock will be at the Chevrolet Performance U.S. Nationals. Working now the semifinals of Funny Cars. John Force, Tommy Johnson Jr. bring their cars to the starting line now. TJ, the lane choice, then Alexis DeJoria, courtesy of that 399 blast, will pick hers against Caps. Well, let's talk a little bit about the points where John Force can take over the point lead. John Force here in the 1990s, Mike Dunn, won 7 of the 10 races held here in that decade, an astounding 33-3 round record.
That was with Austin Coyle calling the shots, and he was pretty impressive, but this man here, Jimmy Prock, also is very impressive.
I just talked to Jimmy Prock, asked him if they're going to try and run a pass in the 3-second zone, and he said he's not sure, Mike, that it will hold because of the way John stages.
Interesting.
Yeah, and John likes to stage a little bit deep in there, so he's kind of maybe a little bit concerned. Just going to go out there and race that racetrack like they always say. All four Funny Car semifinals have been in the 3-second range.
Tommy Johnson moves first. John Force hits the finish line first, 4:02.1. So Jimmy Prock, one step closer to adding to the legacy of John Force at BIR. John's in his fifth consecutive final, too. This team's getting hot.
As you mentioned, he had 300 of a second advantage off the starting line, but then by half track, something happened to Tommy Johnson. Tommy was running 270 miles an hour at the eighth mile, but he's already started to lose a little bit of lap time, and then obviously something failed on that race car, and Johnson advanced to the final.
I'm ready.
And with Jimmy Prock, Jimmy, how challenging has this day been?
Well, it certainly has. You know, the weather's been tough. We haven't raced in conditions like this in quite a while, actually. And, you know, we missed first round, but we've gathered it up here a little bit, and hopefully we can win this race.
Going to try and win again. This will be their seventh trip to the finals this season.
John Force now the new point leader here. Brainerd International Raceway. Ron Capps, Alexis DeJoria. Thundering into your screen. For Alexis, we all know what's at stake. Quickest times of the weekend, two of them, and run by that driver.
I'd say that's pretty impressive. Louis T, the first two rounds coming into the semifinal matchup with Ron Capps. And the good thing for Alexis, like I said, she made that mistake in the first round, but she came back, kept her calm, had a decent reaction time in the next round. In the semi second round when she ran that 3.99 to get the win.
Look what's coming to the staging lanes next. It is the top fuel final here. The skies begin to get dark. Alexis trying to win three races in a single season. No female funny car driver has done that. The last female to win three races in a row in Nitro, Lori Johns, 24 years ago.
What I love about these conditions is all about horsepower and applying that horsepower through the middle of the racetrack. That's why I always emphasize that eighth mile speed, because that gives you an indication not only how good the track conditions are, but how guys are really able to apply that horsepower through the middle. And the previous round, Tommy DeLago, 274 miles per hour, eighth mile, he got it all together through the middle of the racetrack, and that's why it ran the big number.
More three theme. Remember, Ron Capps looking for three in a row at Brainerd. And while we're on the subject, and everybody's running so strong, we've never seen side-by-side three-second runs. We're not going to see it here. Alexis is going to bow out. Ron Capps, 407.3.
Good job. He struck the tires. Good job. We're at 407.
So a classic final. Capps, Force, hold on, Ron Tobler.
Slick up there, Ron. Come on. Smile, Ron, you're in the final like once again in Brainerd. Ron Capps loves this place. You saw Alexis have the back pedal that car.
Good job, he smoked the tires. Good job, ran 407.
Shook the tires early and she had to get out of it. Ron Capps advances to another final.
Ron Tobler, tune in Ron Capps to another final here at Brainerd. How do you keep doing it?
Well, I don't know. I don't think we can keep doing it tonight. I mean, that car was soaking wet when I leaned on it to turn the screw. So hopefully cooler and common sense will prevail. It's nice to get the NAPA car into the third straight final here at Brainerd. We'll just have to wait and see what happens the rest of the night.
Thanks, Ron.
As we mentioned, we already know that the Pro Stock final is going on to Indy. What will happen with the funny car final and Top Fuel in the lanes next?
It's like old times. John Force, Ron Capps are going to be going to a final. What's it like? You've won here so many times, but have you ever had a day this long?
Yeah, but the fans had it just as long. So, you know, if I made any right choices in my career, it's moving people around and teaming, you know, Jimmy Prock with John Medlin. John Medlin's come on real strong with us. He helped design half the stuff in these race cars. And Mike Neff with Robert Height and Little John and Danny, you know, Ron Douglas, all of them. It's just I keep putting people, you know, Smith together with Antonelli and Hood.
And it's working.
And it's working. And to go out there, let me tell you, the last run I told you that old hunk ran 06, but it really ran 99. Jimmy said, no, because I was all over the tree. He said, only ran an 02. Well, that run there, I was all over that tree again, in there deep, and it ran 02. That thing did run 99. But DeJoria, she put the number on the scoreboard. Hey, Capsy, are you ready? Hey.
They're going to have a little stare off here.
We're going to dance. We're dancing, poor style.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that.
I'll be your huckleberry.
Nice. Well, this is the Top Fuel Final. And in it for the third time is Morgan Lucas. We already know he's done it twice. Here's mom Charlotte at the top of the race course. Will she be handing him a trophy yet again? And for Doug, he wins this race. He will go into Indianapolis with a 6-round lead, a virtual lock on the number one seed, a number one seed that has produced 5 of the 7 countdown champions in Top Fuel. Stat guy.
Oh, I love that stat. How about this one? Doug Coletta, the last time he won back-to-back races in a single season, you have to go back 8 years ago in 2006.
How about Morgan Lucas, the number 12 qualifier, barely got down the racetrack in qualifying, but boy, has that thing been running strong in eliminations. Oh, it's ugly.
Whoa, whoa, look at that. Man. He's done it again.
Yeah, yes.
A race that had so many twists and turns, and in a flaming fireball, Morgan Lucas wins just his third race this season.
We're gonna have to do 14 replays to figure out what happened, Dave. Man. Oh, take a look at the first look. Both drivers had the pedal. You saw Doug pedal first, and then right after that, Morgan did it. Doug was getting back on it, then Morgan's on fire, and Morgan was able to get the win. Wow, what a race.
And Doug just flat ran out of real estate.
See, Doug pedaled that thing 3 times trying to get that thing down there. And Morgan was starting to pull away, and then catches it on fire. Then Doug was closing in, but couldn't quite get it.
Morgan Lucas's 10th win, with his father at the starting line, his mother at the top end, getting ready to hand him a little gold man.
Aaron Brooks tuning Morgan to the win. What happened? What could you see from here?
Well, probably just got a little too aggressive in the final, and it smoked the tires. Once he started pedaling out there, it just kind of anybody's guess. Looked like it just blew up.
Yeah, but what a way to win, on fire, right?
Yeah, it was spectacular, to say the least.
Congratulations.
Not sure Aaron Brooks even knows how to assess what he just saw there. I know we're struggling.
That was crazy.
And look at Morgan.
Frank.
There's Charlotte waiting to give him his third Brainerd International Raceway Lucas Oil Top Fuel winning trophy. And here comes his son around the corner.
Was number one qualifier in motorcycle. And we all three won.
What a weekend. Okay, we got to jump in.
Oh, Bubby.
Mom's there to greet him, and for Morgan, Gary, that's his first win as a father.
His first win as a father, the third time that Mom has handed him a Wally for winning a Top Fuel event. How crazy has this day been when you blow it up going through the lights?
I was talking to Doug's guys before I got in the car just like a few minutes ago. It's been crazy. It's almost like Groundhog Day. It's just been raining. It just kind of seems like it's never ending. But this is the ending that you can only dream of. And I missed my wife and son. I wish they could be here. But this one's for you guys. Love my mom and dad. 25 years of Lucas Oil Products, and this is where we're at. It's so exciting right now. And I'll be honest with you, with this bunch of jabronis that I got on this team, these part timers, all these guys we put together, I'm just so proud of them. And you know what? Dreams do come true, and they keep coming true, and I'm just really happy right now, believe me.
Let's get a reaction from Mom. What's it like to watch your son for a third time in Top Fuel ranks, fourth time overall that you've handed him one of those trophies?
There's no words that can ever explain the feeling that you get when you get to hand your own son a trophy for winning a race like this. Especially from what, 11th place?
12th, I think.
12th.
Yeah.
Okay, we're in 12th place, and we won.
Yes, you did. Time to celebrate.
Thank you, Gary.
Not bad for a part-time team.
I'm Well, we got to take at least one more look at this, Dave. We heard Aaron Brooks took, he just flat overpowered the racetrack right there. Morgan caught it quick, but then it just didn't really want to respond when he got back on it. It was sideways. It was mixing it up, start putting oil out the right side, then lights it up on fire, gets it sideways going through the lights at 230 miles per hour. Doug was coming on fast. He was running almost 30 miles an hour faster at the finish line, but could not catch Morgan.
Well, I'm not sure we can have a more fitting way to finish the Lucas Oil Nationals, as NHRA officials have determined they are going to take the Funny Car Final due to darkness, due to some more mist coming down, to the Chevrolet Performance U.S. Nationals in 2 weeks. Congratulations, Morgan Lucas and the entire Lucas Oil family.
Well, it wasn't the quickest or fastest top fuel final we ever seen, but it was one of the most exciting because it had everything. It had lead changes, it had fires, it had backpedaling, it had upsets. Wow!
It was cool. And now it's on to the Chevrolet Performance U.S. Nationals with added storylines as Pro Stock will complete their semis and final in Indy, and a unique opportunity for either John Force or Ron Capps to pull a triple play by winning Indy, the Traxxas Shootout, and a U.S. National Event Trophy all in the same weekend. For our entire ESPN2 crew, I'm Dave Reif. Congratulations, Morgan Lucas, driving the family car, winning the race put on by your parents. Good night from Brandon.